Johnson, Vice President of Corporate Marketing.
Welcome everyone, back to day two of Beyond 2019. So good to see so many of you here, especially after what I understand was a pretty late night last night. And I saw the coffee queue this morning, so I know that it definitely was difficult for some of you. But thank you all for joining us. So, how are you all? Pretty good? Yesterday was fun? Good day of learning? Yes, good, good, good. Well, today we've got a jam-packed agenda for you. Lots of learning opportunities again today. But first, why don't we see the highlights of day one?
Welcome to Beyond. How's everybody doing?
I want to imagine a new world with you, in which bite-sized insights can reach the right person at the right time.
And it's our job while we're here at the face of this planet to do what we can to start to transition things from impossible to possible.
We are intelligent beings. We like to learn, create, we like to share. But at the core of it, we are a social being. Let's move fast and build things together.
Okay, so yesterday we talked a lot about creating data-driven organizations and empowering every single business user to get viral insights to data to make better business decisions. And today we're actually going to pivot a little bit further to actually go into more of how you actually take the learnings from yesterday and apply them to your own business. And ThoughtSpot, we travel all around the world working with lots of global customers and helping them on their digital transformation journey. And what they tell us is that there's actually what can be codified into four areas of success is, number one, culture. Number two, it's around business use cases. Number three, amazing technology. And number four, amazing partner ecosystem. So today we're actually going to delve into those four areas a little more. So in order for you to actually release your own personal insights and for you to drive forward the organizations, we want to ask you just, sorry, one question. So how happy are you right now? Okay. Okay, well, today we have a speaker here who actually is going to connect success and happiness together. His name is Sean Acor. Now, Sean is going to talk us through how he makes that connection. And I can't think of anyone better to actually share that research today. Now, I need to read his bio because he has a long bio here. So, Sean is the best-selling author of The Happiness Advantage and Big Potential. He spent 12 years at Harvard, where he won over a dozen distinguished teaching awards. Sean has since become the world's leading expert on the connection between happiness and success, which has helped make him sought after by the likes of the NFL, the Pentagon, and the US Treasury. His TED Talk is the most popular of all time, with 16 million views. And the accolade that I personally find really interesting about this, the most impressive, is that he actually recently sat down and had a two-hour interview with none other than Oprah Winfrey, which pretty much means he's made it. So I'm so happy to have him here to talk about happiness. Please happily welcome him to the stage, Sean Acor.
Hi, good morning, everyone. I'm so thrilled and honored to have this opportunity to come speak with you. I have to tell you that this is a thrill to get to talk about this research, because when I first got into doing this research, actually when I first went off to college to start collecting debts, my father was buoyed by the idea that maybe someday I might come back and I might be a doctor or a lawyer or a banker, something he thought would make a lot of sense. And when I came home from college and told him, "Dad, I want to study the science of happiness," he sat me down. My father is a neuroscientist at Baylor University down in Waco, Texas, and he told me that the average scientific journal article is only read on average by 7 people total, which is incredibly depressing for a researcher to hear, especially because I know that that statistic also includes my mom. So now we're down to 6 people who read these studies, which is a travesty because what we've been learning about literally transforms what it means to be human. What I would love to do this morning is to share some of that research with you that I think can show you how much we can change from our genetic set point to raise our levels of optimism in almost any environment. And when that occurs, when the brain becomes more positive, every single business and educational outcome we know how to test for rises dramatically, and many of our health outcomes as well. But it doesn't just stop there. It ripples out to the people around us, to the clients that we serve, our family members, our coworkers, and the community around us as well. So this talk is not just for you. It's also for all the people that aren't in this room this morning as we try to create a positive change in this world around us. Where I wanted to start my talk here this morning is where I started my TED talk, and then we'll deviate completely from there to talk about all this new research. But I started all of this research when I was just 7 years old. So if any of you have children, and they're 7, and they're not doing academic research, you're clearly not pushing them hard enough. But when I was 7 and my sister was 5 years old, I was 2 years older than my sister at the time, and we were playing up on, and I'm 2 years older than her now, but at the time, that meant she had to do everything I wanted to do, and I wanted to play war. So we're up on top of these bunk beds. How many of you had bunk beds growing up? Did anyone else have bunk beds? I loved them. I would still have them now if they were socially acceptable at all for a married guy. So on one side of the bunk bed, I had all of my G.I. Joe soldiers and weaponry lined up. And on my sister's side, she had all of her My Little Ponies and unicorns lined up for this cavalry charge. And I wasn't too concerned about what was going to happen. I'd won this war every single time we'd played in the past. And if I was losing, the rules of engagement would change. There are differing accounts of what happened that afternoon. But since my sister was not invited to come speak with you here this morning, you get to hear the true story. Which is, my sister is a little bit on the clumsy side, and somehow, without any help or push from her loving older brother at all, suddenly Amy disappeared off of the top of the bunk bed and landed with this crash on the floor. And I nervously peered over the side of the bed to see what had befallen my fallen sister, and saw that she landed painfully on her hands and knees and all fours on the ground. I was nervous because my parents had charged me with making sure that Amy and I played as safely and as quietly as possible. And seeing as how I had accidentally broken Amy's arm 1 week before this, don't take her side, you don't know her, but I was trying as hard as I could to be on my best behavior, and I saw my sister's face, this wail of pain and suffering and surprise, threatening to erupt from her mouth and threatening to wake my parents from the long winter nap for which they had just settled. So I did the only thing that my little frantic 7-year-old brain could think to do to avert this tragedy, and if you have children, you've seen this hundreds of times before. I said, Amy, wait, please, 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 please don't cry. Did you see how you landed? No human lands on all fours like that. She stopped mid-cry with confusion on her face and looked up at me, and I had no idea where else I was going. That was the extent of the strategy. So I blurted out the only other thing I could think of, which is, Amy, I think this means you're a unicorn, which was cheating, because there's nothing in the world Amy would have wanted more in that moment to not be Amy, the hurt 5-year-old little sister, but Amy, the special unicorn, of course, an option open to her brain at no point in the past. And you could see on my poor, manipulated sister's face conflict as her brain attempted to devote resources to feeling the pain and suffering and surprise she'd experienced falling off of a bunk bed or contemplating this newfound identity as a unicorn on the other side. And the latter won out. Instead of crying, instead of ceasing our play, instead of waking my parents with all the negative consequences that would have ensued for me, instead a smile spread across her face, and she bounded right back up onto the bunk bed with all the grace of a baby unicorn with one broken leg. What we had stumbled across at that tender age of 5 and 7, we had no idea at the time, was something that was going to be at the vanguard of a scientific revolution we're lucky enough to be living through right now. What we're learning more and more now that we have neuroimaging is how limited the brain is. You have a limited and finite amount of resources. So whatever you attend to first actually becomes your reality. So if your brain is constantly scanning first for the negatives, the hassles, the complaints, the frustrations, and threats that are omnipresent in any environment, our brains lose the ability to scan that environment for things we're grateful for, or the meaning involved with the work that we have, or our relationships, or the ways we could transform this reality into a better reality. What we had stumbled across is this idea that it sounds as if scientifically happiness could be a choice. The problem is that we tell people in high school science classes that you're only your genes and your environment, but the average person doesn't fight their genes and their environment. So what we keep finding is you can only be whatever your genes give you and your environment gives you in terms of your happiness and your success rates. But when you look back into the data, what you see is a different picture emerge. What you find are these outliers. You find these weirdos in the data that for some reason they change the way that they work. They change a daily habit pattern. They change the people that they hang out with. And when that occurs, it turns out they break the tyranny of genes and environment over the trajectory of their levels of optimism, and then suddenly every single one of their business and educational outcomes improve dramatically. What we're finding is that the greatest competitive advantage in the modern economy is not something the lucky inherit, it's something that could be cultivated. And if it can be cultivated, then it could be taught. And what we got fascinated by is how much our mindset then has a ripple effect to the people around us, creating that same advantage in other people's lives as well. In order to start this and to show you this research, what I'd love to do with you here this morning, and I've been excited to do this ever since I got invited to come speak with you, is I'd love to do a brief experiment with you here today. You don't have to do any of my experiments. I'm not allowed to bring consent forms to talks anymore after the electric shock problem we had the last time in Dallas. But if you're willing to participate, all I need you to do is to please partner up with someone that you're sitting next to. Please partner up into pairs of two. The only caveat is I'm legally required to tell you that you cannot partner up with someone that you're married to for this experiment, or that you wish you were married to. So move around if that's a problem for you. So partner up with someone you're currently not married to and introduce yourself, please. It's okay if there's one person that's odd in the group. It's more fun to just watch this one. So here's what I'd love for you to do. The person sitting closest to this wall over here, you're person number one in the pair. The person furthest from that wall, you're person number two in the pair. There should be a one and a two in each group. If you're front to back, the person closest to me is person number one. If neither of those apply, you can pick one person to be number one. So raise your hand if you're person number one for this experiment. Raise your hand if you're person number two. Okay, that's not the experiment. I have to do this now because I did this experiment on Wall Street a few months ago, and it literally took that bank 5 minutes to figure out who number one in the group was, which explained what was going on there. So how many of you are psychology friends? You have a psychology degree or you read a lot of psychology books? Do I have any? Oh, I have a couple. So for my psychology friends, this is the emotional prime of the experiment. And for everyone else, this is nothing. Over the course of your life, you've taken your genetic predispositions, your genes. You've built those genes up with your self-discipline and your self-control. You're able to pass the classes you needed to in school, to get into the jobs you want to apply yourself to your work, to your family, and to your friends. You're so successful, you're here in this room right now. What I'd love for you to do is use all that self-discipline and control that you've been cultivating for decades, and I'd like you to use it to control your behavior for just 7 seconds with your partner if you can. At 8 seconds, you can do whatever you like to or with your partner, but for 7 seconds, we need you to control yourself. So person number one, what we ask you to do in this experiment, person number one, what we ask you to do in this experiment is to not get angry with person number two when they do to you what I'm about to tell them to do to you. Person number one, don't get angry, don't get sad. Please, please don't cry like the group a couple weeks ago. That was so embarrassing. That was at the Pentagon. So I basically need you to do nothing with your partner. Person number one and two, please turn and face one another. Person number one, make sure you're within striking distance of person number two. And person number one, just go neutral on the inside. Try to feel no emotions and try and think no thoughts, which after last night for most of you is going to be very easy this morning. Then person number one, don't move your hands from this point in the experiment, even to defend yourself from person number two. And see, some of you take off your glasses. That's a great idea. And person number one, just go neutral on your face. Show zero emotion on your face. No fear, no flinching, no frustration, just zero emotion. Once you're ready, person number one, you're using your decades of self-discipline and control to control your thoughts, your emotions, your hands, and your face. Then person number two, please look at them. Make sure you're looking at them directly in the eyes. And for the next 7 seconds, person number two, please smile genuinely and warmly, but directly up into the eyes of person number one while looking at them as warmly and as deeply as possible. Ready, go. And stop. So I'm sorry, we're going to need to do that one more time. Person number two, I'm so sorry. I didn't realize you were the one with all the power and control in this relationship. Now, my few psychology friends know you never repeat a psychology experiment with deception in it, but let's just try it. Person number two, go neutral on the inside. Feel no emotions. Think no thoughts. Control your face with your decades of self-discipline and control. Person number one, please look at them. Make sure you're looking at them directly in the eyes. And for the next 7 seconds, it's your turn for retaliation. Please smile genuinely and warmly directly into their eyes while looking at them as warmly and as deeply as possible. Ready, go. And stop. So my favorite part about this experiment, my favorite part by far, is as soon as I say stop, everyone in the room relaxes as if that was a difficult task to do. Some of you are like, I did it. You did nothing. For 7 seconds. Failure in this experiment. Failure meant you smiled when I asked you not to. Success meant that you did not smile for the full 7 seconds. Raise your hand if you failed miserably in this experiment by smiling when you were not supposed to be smiling here this morning. Look around the room. That's incredibly high and terrible. Raise your hand if you successfully did what I asked you to for the full 7 seconds. You did not smile. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and let's double it, 14 liars. And so I've done this experiment now in 51 countries across the globe. 80 to 85% of people worldwide cannot control themselves for the 7 seconds of this experiment. I've done this with senior level bankers, all men, all in their mid-50s in Tokyo, Japan, and the smile percentage was in the mid-70s. Extraordinarily universal response. Now this experiment in this form is predictive of nothing, but it illustrates something that transforms what it means to be human, and we never get research like this. What we discovered by accident is if you put me into an fMRI brain scan and scan my brain while I'm smiling, small portions of my brain will show activation, basically saying, Sean, you're smiling, which we knew had happened, I'm smiling. But if I stop smiling and you keep scanning me and you flash an image of one of you smiling in front of me, small little portions of my brain, the mirroring systems of my brain will start to activate. When they activate, they say, Sean, you're smiling. But this time, I'm not smiling. You're smiling. But before I can stop myself, my brain drops a neurochemical many of you know called dopamine into my system, raising my levels of happiness and enjoyment and causing my face to contort into a smile before I can stop myself. You might have seen this reaction here this morning. If you're looking at your partner while you're smiling at them and their lips were quivering while they were trying not to smile, that's weird. That shouldn't be happening. What's happening there is that their mirror system is fighting against the motor system. The brain already thinks it's smiling. It's like, what's the problem here, face? You've seen this before. If you've ever had to speak to a group of people at a conference and one person starts to yawn and then other people start to yawn, that's not because you're boring. That can't possibly be it. I keep telling myself. What's happening there is as I see people in my visual field start to yawn, my mirror systems tell me I'm the one that's yawning. And I could pick up the fatigue response of someone sitting all the way across the room. Where this gets fascinating is if you have 15 strangers waiting for a plane, they don't even know they're part of an experiment, they're just waiting at their gate for their plane, you introduce an undercover researcher to stand in the middle of the 15 people in a 5-meter radius, and the undercover researcher begins to bounce nervously in place, tap his foot impatiently on the ground, and look at his watch repeatedly with a frown on his face. Within 2 minutes of waiting for that plane or train, depending on the study worldwide, on average, 7 to 12 of the 15 individuals unconsciously start shifting nervously in place and or tapping their foot on the ground and or looking at their watch more than 4 times in a 2-minute span of time. If you don't believe me, this is one of the experiments you get to try out yourself the next time you get on a plane, if you want to spread stress and negativity to the people on your plane. Which is why I always do this one at a different gate. But the reason I love this experiment is because it shows us not only do smiles and yawns spread, but it turns out that negativity, stress, uncertainty, and anxiety, we can pick up like secondhand smoke. You don't have to be the one smoking to have the negative health implications. We've got 3 decades worth of research on that. We have 2 decades worth of research showing that the same thing is true with how other people's brains process your reality. As soon as we tell people that, I think they make a mistake. They immediately think, well, then here are all the people I'm cutting out of my life. But I think that there's a more valuable response. I've been fascinated recently with the interconnections between happiness and success. And I wrote a book that came out last year in February called Big Potential. And it was changing what I've been doing up to that point. What I've been focusing on was the happiness advantage, which is if we can change your individual habits, your happiness score rises, and your success rates rise. What we got fascinated by is when that happens, the people around them start to change as well. and that there's a reciprocal response where it becomes easier to choose to be positive when people around you are positive and vice versa. So we got fascinated looking at interconnected success and happiness. So I wrote this book. It came out in February of last year because I have a daughter who my wife was pregnant at the time, and she was going to be born in mid-April. So I could go on a 30-day long book tour, then completely get off the road and just be there for my wife and our daughter. During the first week of February, as Big Potential came out, during the Super Bowl, during the first quarter, while the Patriots were playing, my wife's water broke, which we didn't even know was a thing. Because it was 2.5 months early, and it was during the Super Bowl. So she Ubered to the hospital, and she got there. Husband of the year. I got her an XL, though. And she got there. And they said, ma'am, your water broke. You have to stay here for the next 6 weeks trying to hold this baby in, which we also didn't know was a thing. And it turns out it wasn't. 3 days later, our daughter was born. In the same week, this book came out. And instead of going on a 40-day long book tour, for the next 50 days, my happiness sat in an incubator in NICU, being cared for by people they were caring for in a way that I had zero chance of success rate of being able to care for her. And it turns out, in the midst of this, we got to battle test the research I get to share with you right now. Big Potential starts with two studies that I think are fascinating. The first one is two researchers in Virginia discovered that if I look at a hill I need to climb in front of me, if I look at that hill by myself, my brain shows me a picture of a hill. It constructs a picture of a hill that is 10 to 20% steeper than a hill of the same height I perceive while standing next to someone who's going to climb it with me. That shouldn't be happening. The hill's not changing. But the inclusion of another person who's planning on climbing that challenge changes how steep that hill is portrayed within my brain. Turns out the shapes of this room, the geometry within our life, the obstacles in front of us are constantly in flux based upon a couple of things. One of them is whether or not you feel like you're alone overcoming this challenge or with other people. The reason I want to share that with you is because, by the way, it's not just the physical ones, it's the emotional ones now too, and they're larger. Trying to overcome educational debt, trying to graduate from college, trying to hit a sales target, trying to raise a family in the midst of your work, trying to overcome depression and anxiety. Those hills change based upon whether or not you think you're alone doing this or with other people in that process, which means these happiness books don't belong in the self-help section of Barnes & Noble, because as soon as you make happiness self-help, you make it 10 to 20% steeper for people to overcome. What I'm fascinated by is how much we can actually reach out to others to find greater levels of happiness and meaning within our work and our life, which led to a second study. In 1935, a biologist was going down a river in southeast Indonesia. He was told one thing: make sure you're back to the camp before darkness falls, because there's no lights in the boat. So he didn't make it back in time. So here's this scrawny academic, the first time he's left the Pacific Northwest in the United States, for the first time his whole life, floating down in the pitch dark in a jungle in southeast Indonesia. Terrified, he's about to get eaten by a predator. He looked up at one of the mangrove trees and it got struck by lightning. And then in the darkness, the same tree got struck by lightning again. And then in a reality-bending moment, every single mangrove tree on one side of the river for 100 yards got struck by lightning. When his faculties recovered, he realized lightning wasn't coming down, it was coming out. And that the trees in this magical moment of nature were covered with a swarm of bioluminescent lightning bugs. But they don't swarm, actually. But they were covering every single inch of the tree. But what he reported seeing in the historical documents is he said that instead of lighting up individually and randomly, like fireflies do here in Dallas, he said that millions of these lightning bugs were lighting up and going dark simultaneously, simulating a lightning strike. He went back to the United States and wrote up a scientific paper called The Miracle in the Mangroves, the case of the synchronous lightning bugs of southeast Indonesia. And no one believed him and he lost his job. And the reason for that is that's crazy. It's crazy because we know how the world works. It's survival of the fittest. You have to be the fastest, smartest, brightest light shining. The whole point of being a lightning bug is to light up in the dark to increase your chances of sexual reproduction. Why in the world would you light up when your competition's lit up? That doesn't make any sense at all. And mathematicians said this is impossible. For order to come out of chaos, someone has to lead it. So who's the one lightning bug telling everyone else when to light up? Physically, mathematically, biologically, impossible. 8 decades later, 3 years ago, two researchers at MIT discovered that in two places in the globe, lightning bugs have figured out how to do something different. Instead of lighting up individually and randomly, they light up as an interconnected community, timing their pulses to the millisecond. One in southeast Indonesia, and one on the opposite part of the globe in the Smoky Mountains of Tennessee. And it turns out, when lightning bugs light up individually and randomly, like they figured out how to do across the entire globe, turns out their success rates of reproduction per night are 3%. which is still really good. But it turns out that in those two places in the globe where they light up as an interconnected community, the success rate goes from 3% to 82% per bug. It's not like one bug's doing really well with this new system. I keep going, guys. This is the best night of my life. Right? The entire system was doing orders of magnitude better than we thought was possible because we thought we knew how the world works and we'll constrain it that way. Turns out, we don't actually live in a world of survival of the fittest. We live in a world of survival of the best fit with the ecosystem of the potential around us. And what we're finding continually is if we want to see the majority of our potential, we can't do so individually and alone. We can only do so when linked to and enhancing and defending the ecosystem of potential around us, which led to some of the studies we were initially looking at back at Harvard. So I grew up in Waco, Texas, just south of here. I lived there for 18 years. When it came time for college, we didn't have money for college, which was fine. I was going to stay in Waco for free. I applied to Harvard on a dare, but I wasn't valedictorian. I was a volunteer firefighter back in Waco. And this is Waco of the 80s. This is before Chris and Joanna Gaines got there and fixed it up. So but then they let me in, and then we couldn't afford it. And then 3 weeks later, I got a Navy ROTC scholarship that paid for the tuition. And suddenly, something that wasn't even a possibility became a reality. Only reason I'm sharing that biographical information is listen how it flips the research. Because when I arrived on campus, I found myself in rooms full of people that were much smarter than me or better academically prepared than me. And I could have felt bad about myself, but I remember sitting there thinking, I can't believe I get the privilege of being surrounded by all these people. There is future poets and philosophers and engineers. They were all talking about Facebook, but it was amazing. You could see on their faces the ones who saw that education as a privilege instead of as an expectation. When they saw their education as a privilege, they invested in a different way. They'd take classes that they might get a bad grade in just because they wanted to learn. They'd ride the bench for 4 years in a sport they weren't first a starter for because they wanted to make friends and they liked the sport. Turns out they loved their time there. Turns out those are the students who give the most alumni donations back to the school afterwards, which is why Harvard got interested in happiness in the first place. But then I realized that if I left when I graduated, they're not going to let me back in. So I just stayed. I graduated that summer. I moved back into the freshman dorms and lived there for the next 8 years. My mom was so proud. But in exchange for a room and board, which is what I needed to live there, they give you 30 freshmen a year, and your job is to counsel them during the first year of being in a hyper-competitive environment. You live in the dorms with them, you eat all your meals with them, you counsel them, you read their admissions files, and 3 years after doing it, I realized a pattern. No matter how happy they were getting into the school that they wanted to go to, 3 weeks later, their brains were not focused on the privilege of being there, nor fully focused on philosophy or physics. Their brains become scattered, thinking about the competition, the workload, the stresses, the hassles, the complaints, and what's going to happen to me 4 years from now. Same thing that happens anytime you get hired at a new organization. At Harvard, though, 80% of the students then go through depression. 80% of them go through work debilitating depression at some time during their 4 years there. 10% of them report contemplating suicide at some time during their 4 years there at Harvard. But now that I've done this in 51 countries, what we realized was the story had nothing to do with Harvard. Had nothing to do with privileged Ivy League students. The story had to do with every single human brain in the world as we contemplate the connection between our previous life successes, how much happiness we think is possible given in our near and far future. When my friends from Waco would come to visit me, the very first thing they'd do is they'd walk into the freshman dining hall, vaulted wooden ceilings, Tiffany stained glass along the sides. They'd roll their eyes and say, "This looks like something out of Hogwarts from Harry Potter. Why would you waste your time studying happiness at Harvard?" Of course they're happy. They're at Hogwarts. Why aren't you in the slums of Venezuela or an impoverished school in Africa or in a children's cancer ward? Then we'll talk about whether or not happiness is a choice. Since then, I've researched in all those places, but their question shows something very important. The question assumes that your external world has a tyranny over your levels of happiness. That if I know if a student's at Harvard versus the students I was working with in a shanty town in Soweto, South Africa, we know who's happier, right? But we don't. For those of you who have done international travel, you continually are shocked by people who have so much less means than we have, who have greater levels of access to gratitude and joy within their lives. The question is why? Sonia Lubomirsky out in California, one of the researchers, argues that only 10% of our long-term levels of happiness is predicted based upon our level, based upon the external world. 90% of it's still based upon the external world. It's just how your brain processes the world. How do you process your pay? How do you process your job, your spouse, your kids, or the weather? If we could change the processing, remarkable things start to occur, and then we start to be able to change the external reality. In the 80s, they got really excited getting these four-year-olds to put blocks together, testing spatial memory, because they were trying to figure out how young they could do it. Then they got excited. What if we asked them before doing the blocks experiment to think of their happiest memory? Now, they're four-year-olds, so they say something like, I had Jell-O for lunch. That was the happiest memory of my entire life. And you get those parents pounding on the glass. It was Disney. I spent so much money. But whatever it is that causes a child to be happy and not the kid, they were putting the blocks together with an accuracy rate that was 60% higher than the children just given neutral instructions. They almost threw out the data because it's a very simple task. They're four-year-olds, and happiness and spatial memory are separate parts of the brain. But then they found out in 1998, if you prime a doctor to become more positive, he or she is 19% faster and more accurate at coming up with the correct diagnosis. Then at MetLife, amongst the insurance salesmen, they found that the top 10% of optimists were outselling the other 90% of the sales force by another 89%. But they weren't hiring based upon optimism, so they did a multi-million-dollar gamble, hired people that were low on the industry standard test, but high in levels of optimism. They didn't tell them they're part of the special hiring force because it'd be a very awkward conversation. You're not that smart, but boy, are you happy. Welcome aboard. By year one, they outsold the normal hires by 26%. By year two, is 57%. The greatest predictor of sales success is your optimism score. Your productivity rises by 31% when your brain is positive, as opposed to negative, neutral, or stress. Turns out, your likelihood of promotion rises by 40%. Same level of stress when you see the meaning involved with your stress, 23% drop in the negative health effects of stress upon the system. Creativity triples. Intelligence rises. Everything we test for on the ACT and SAT rises significantly. To summarize it, every business outcome we know how to test for at Harvard Business School rises dramatically when the human brain is positive first. Every single thing we test for on the ACT and SAT standardized tests rises dramatically when the human brain is in a positive state. Which means something important. We oftentimes think about takeaways at a talk being something that's very focused on a very practical takeaway. But I think the very first one is a mental takeaway. I think we follow the wrong formula for happiness and success. We keep thinking to ourselves, if I work harder, I'm going to be more successful. And as soon as I achieve these goals and figure out these problems that you're going to be talking about while you're here at the conference and figure out products and solutions and how the next couple years look like for you, we keep thinking, if I work harder, I'll be successful, then I'll feel happier. The problem with that formula is every time your brain has a success, your brain is designed to change the goalpost of what success looks like. Otherwise, the very first time you put blocks together as a four-year-old, you could have been done. You could have been done in terms of happiness and success. If I ask you if you're happy and successful today, you're like, yep, I put those Legos together when I was four. What else do I need? But we keep raising the bar, and it's adaptive. We want to do that. But think how often we make the mistake. We keep thinking, as soon as I get to the weekend, then I'll feel happier. As soon as I get a job, think of how happy I'll be. As soon as I finish college, as soon as I finish my education, as soon as I pay off my debts, as soon as I get married, think how happy I'm going to be. Remember that one, right? Or as soon as I have kids, think how happy I'll be. Once they're healthy, once they're in the right school, once they're dating somebody I want, once they have a job, once I'm retired, think how happy I'm going to be. What happens in each one of those moments is every time your brain hits that new target, that new net worth, it turns out your brain changes the goalpost of what success looks like. So if happiness is on the opposite side of success, empirically and scientifically, that formula doesn't work, right? Because happiness will continually be off over the cognitive horizon. Otherwise, the happiest people in the world would be the richest people, the celebrities, the professional athletes, and professional musicians. And we can see, based on the mental health rates, that's not what's happening. But flip it around. If we can deepen, in the midst of the challenges you have right now, if we can deepen somehow either your optimism, your social connection, or your gratitude, it turns out that every single business and educational outcome rises dramatically for you. So your success rates rise lockstep with it. Turns out there was a correlation between happiness and success. There was actually causation that was occurring there. It was just flowing the opposite direction of what we thought it was going to happen. Success doesn't yield higher levels of happiness. I was just out at Pebble Beach giving a talk last week, and what we realized was, you know, the people that are out golfing there are much more proficient than the kids that are doing putt-putt, right? But the kids doing putt-putt are having a much better time than the much more successful golfers. Part of the reason for that is success doesn't garner higher levels of happiness automatically. But it turns out when you're in a positive state, turns out golfing performance rises, educational outcomes improve, business outcome improve, in the band of your potential. If you can be high or low compared to other people, but you're in the low end of your own potential when your brain is in a negative state. So the question is, how do we change? How, in the midst of challenge, do we find a way of pursuing positivity at a conference, post a conference, as we're trying to build our businesses and our families? In order to study that, we had to study video games. How many people play the video game Tetris? A lot of you. Tetris is a video game where shapes fall from the ceiling, just like they do in real life, and you rotate those shapes around. The goal of Tetris is to make straight lines. Harvard Medical School paid students to play Tetris for 5 hours in a row. At the end of the experiment, they realized that they were screwing up their participants and were forced to stop the experiment. One of the participants came up to the professor 3 weeks later, grabbed this old professor, turned around, said, "Professor, I need to tell you something. You're going to think I'm crazy, but after that experiment, where you made me sit in the basement of that laboratory for 5 hours playing that game, I walked out of the experiment, met up with one of my friends, we walked into a supermarket, and she found me rearranging the bread on the shelves to make straight lines. She said, am I crazy?" He said, yes, you are. "Please stop touching me." But it turns out she wasn't the only one doing this. People were dreaming about Tetris. Has anyone here dreamed about Tetris? We get one per 300 usually. There's one, two, three, four. What we find is if you view the world through the same pattern for too long, your brain keeps it even if it stops working for you. It's called a Tetris effect or a cognitive after image. I was working with a large accounting firm. I was working with KPMG, working with their tax auditors, trying to make tax auditors happier. And one of the things we found is that many of these auditors would spend 8 to 14 hours a day reading through tax forms, looking for mistakes and errors, which make them great at their job. Then they get promoted and levels of happiness drop. I came in to work with them, and one of the guys in the control group came up to me. He said, "Over the past 3 years, I've been getting about 20% less work done. I just don't find meaning in this work anymore. I'm struggling to find happiness." I said, I'm so sorry you're experiencing this. "What have you done to fix this?" He said, "I've already tried everything. One day at lunch, I decided to sit down at my desk. I didn't go eat. I just sat there, and I made an Excel spreadsheet." I was like, I don't think that's going to help you at all. You should be eating. He said, "No, I realized that this was impacting me at home, so I need to open up a dialogue with my wife. So I made a list of all the things I wanted to talk to my wife about. I made a spreadsheet of all the mistakes I felt like she'd been making in our relationship over the past 6 months. So we could work on it together, or even prioritize it for her. I printed the spreadsheet out, brought this home to my ex-wife, handed this to her." He told the story word for word like this, and what I realized was, this is not a bad person. Here's someone who got stuck. He trained his brain to look for mistakes and errors, which made him great at one function of his job that kept getting rewarded. But he was never equally rewarded or trained or focused upon scanning for the strengths that were emerging, the relationships he was having with his clients or the people they worked with, the successes his clients were having because of his work, the fact that he was putting food on the table for his family. So when he became a leader inside the organization, all he had been trained in his brain to do was a pattern, a Tetris effect, of scanning the world for the mistakes and errors on this team. Nothing to praise or recognize. When he came home, he was treating his wife and his son unconsciously as a tax form. "If I can eliminate these flaws and blemishes in them, think how much I would love them then." What's happening in those moments is, as we do conservative risk analysis, as coders are looking for the errors in data, as lawyers are looking for the problems in a document, as we get alerts on our watches and our phone for the bad that's going on in the world, as we get, I just work with 911 operators who answer the phone, hear a trauma, connect you to the hospital, and then wait for the next trauma, that when they leave, their brain is constantly scanning for those traumas in our life. As you open up your inboxes, looking for the fires you need to put out today, you'll watch yourself do this, your brain becomes an expert at scanning whatever environment you have for the negatives, the hassles, the complaints, the frustrations, the fires we need to put out, and the threats that are omnipresent in any environment. But to come back to my unicorn sister Amy from the beginning, whatever we attend to first becomes our reality, which means that our brain, as you scan for the threats, you're pulling resources from the only part of the brain that processes joy and gratitude and meaning. So as you're thinking about all those things, those problems, the to-do list you have over the course of the day, if I can just get these things done, then I'll feel happier at the end of the day. Your brain doesn't process happiness and gratitude or social connection or meaning throughout the entire working phase, which means we miss out on the greatest competitive advantage in the modern economy. So I met up with a former U.S. Surgeon General, and we were looking at basically happiness hygiene habits. Because one of the complaints we get is, you can't really change your happiness, it's genetic. But everyone in this room has genes for teeth that rot out. Everyone, your teeth should rot out by age 15, and we're not sharks, we don't get new teeth. That's just the end of the story. Our genes predispose us to have rotted out teeth. Hopefully it's just not a sign of sexual fitness, unless you brush your teeth. As soon as you brush your teeth, look what happens when everyone brushes their teeth to a population. Humanity looks completely different, right? You have genes for rotted out teeth, and yet most of you do not have rotted out teeth, right? The reason for that is you inserted a 30-second behavioral change into your day, and suddenly a different picture of humanity emerges. We now believe the exact same thing is true for happiness. We now think that we've been defaulting to our genetic set point, which is scanning for threats. But if you insert a 30-second to a 2-minute habit into somebody's day, we can dramatically raise your levels of happiness, gratitude, optimism, and social connection. And in doing so, raise every single one of your business and educational outcomes, triple your creativity, and raise your intelligence scores. I'm going to talk about just two of them, because we know if I give you a list of 10 of them, you do none of them. So what I'm interested in is if I can tell you about two of them and you pick up just one. All of this research is done in isolation on a single habit. So if you pick up one behavioral change post this conference, you actually reap the benefits that we've been talking about here today. The first one was based on gratitude. At American Express, I came in and for 21 days in a row, had them think of three things that they're grateful for every day to start their work. 21 days later, no impact upon them. None. I thought it would work. Gratitude's good for you. No impact. And that's why we researched this, because I thought it would work and I was wrong. But I look back into the data, and by day three, everyone repeats. I'm grateful for my work, my family, and my health. Then with a very nuanced lens, you scan the world for the fires you need to put out. Two researchers, Emmons McCullough, found that it doesn't matter what you're grateful for in life. It doesn't matter at all what you're grateful for. What matters is the scanning. And as your brain scans for things you're grateful for, your brain has to devote resources to doing so. If you get people to think of three new things that they're grateful for 21 days in a row, for 45 seconds while they brush their teeth, their brain basically creates a background app, passively scanning the world with resources, looking for the positive that they can mention in their gratitudes the next day when they do that activity. And as a result of that, same job, same spouse, same world, your brain starts to pick up on positive information that it was basically putting into a spam filter. When that occurs, people that were testing as genetic pessimists suddenly start testing 21 days later as low-level optimists on average. That shouldn't be happening. That's one of the genetic ones. We can't touch it. We've been told you're born a pessimist, you die a pessimist, that's the end of the story. That's not the story at all. That's the genetic set point. Turns out, that's like having rotted out teeth. But it turns out if you add in a 30-second disruptor, just like brushing your teeth, you get a completely different pattern emerge where we get people's levels of optimism rise dramatically over the genetic set point. At Columbia, they found if you do it for 6 months in a row, you move to low to moderate level optimism. 84-year-old men, same pattern. 4-year-old children around a dinner table, predisposed towards pessimism, you do it for 6 weeks in a row. 6 months later, before and after school, they're testing as low-level optimist, which is why we're working with the schools right now. I'm working with all the schools in Flint, Michigan, in the midst of a water crisis, in the midst of cyclical poverty, because we're finding that we went into the poorest county in Iowa, bottom 10% school nationwide. We got just the staff and the teachers to do this gratitude exercise. ACT scores rose by 3.5 points for the students. They now have a 91% graduation rate, 95% attendance rate, and for the first time in Iowa history, kids from the richer counties are coming to the poorest county in Iowa to get a better education, 60 a year. Up in Schaumburg in Chicago, during the same period of time where they went from 8% students on the free lunch program to 35%, so the poverty in their district rose almost by 30%. During that same period of time, they went from the 73rd academic percentile using these gratitude exercises to the 95th percentile in Illinois and now top 2% for the nation. The reason I'm mentioning that is what we're realizing, given the huge challenges you have at work, but given the huge challenges you have in the macroeconomic environment, cyclical poverty, trying to graduate from college, right? A water crisis. What we're finding is these small little things that sound like a cute takeaway at the end of the talk are powerful enough to reverse the courses that we're seeing. If I tell you to go meditate for 90 days on a mountainside after a conference, a few of you might do it, but you'll probably lose your job, right? But what we're interested in is that the chances of you doing it are very, very low, right? It will have a benefit. We can test it on neuroimaging. So instead of a 90 days, what we find is if we get you for 2 minutes a day to just watch your breath go in and out, that 2 minutes starts to have a beneficial effect where your levels of accuracy rise by 10% on the projects you're working on, happiness levels rise, and stress levels drop as well. Gratitude, like meditation, works, but you don't need a huge long period. You can even have these small interventions as well. One last one on that one, and I'll move off to the very final habit. But we actually have to tell you two real quick ones. At I get a lot of companies that say, you know, it's not part of our culture to sit around holding hands, looking into each other's eyes, talking about gratitudes. We work with hundreds of millions of dollars. We have to work really fast. It's a high stress environment. We're very serious. We're not like Zappos. So we said, okay. So we went out to a level one trauma hospital with doctors that have been doing this for 20 years, with grizzled veterans whose job it is to tell you who dies at the hospital based upon their resources. And with them, at every single staff meeting of the hospital, every staff meeting starts with one person in the room, every person in the room saying one thing that they're grateful for. It took all of our social capital to get it off the ground, to do something that we do in a pre-K class with these grizzled veterans. They said, if you come into this meeting, we need to go fast through these gratitudes. So you already come in with one thing you're grateful for so we can get to our real work, because we got to go fast on this. But they did it for 2 years, which is phenomenal. It became part of their embedded culture. 2 years after they started this, the Pulse nightclub shooting occurred 3 blocks down from them. Now the second largest shooting in US history. You never hear this on the news, but all the victims from that came to teams that had been practicing for 2 years about doing these gratitude interventions. The next morning, after the worst trauma their community experienced, they started their staff meetings with things that they were grateful for. And what they said it was universal. They were so grateful they hadn't wasted 2 years of their life only working with the people that they worked with. They were also, in addition to working with people, hearing these points of human connection, even small ones, that deepen their social bonds, which we now know is the greatest predictor of resilience when times get difficult. So what we're finding is this is one of the ways you can actually move this into phone calls that you have and meetings. It becomes a culture. Because if you think about it, if you believe that when our brain is positive, we outperform our brain in negative, neutral, or stressed, if you believe that portion of it and all this research, then the next question you should be asking is, what work routines am I doing to increase the levels of positivity and happiness before I or my team do their work? If you don't have one, gratitude is a perfect one to be able to insert there. And the final one is the most powerful of the interventions we look at. 5 years ago, my son Leah was born in February as well. My wife said I was traveling too much. I was giving about 100 talks a year, and she said, you can't go anywhere in February unless like Oprah calls. And then 3 days later, Oprah called. I was like, Michelle, that's amazing. Say somebody else also. And then 3 days after Leah was born, I found myself in the backyard of Oprah's house talking about happiness research. I had never met a celebrity. I thought I'd be normal. I wasn't. She had this redwood forest on her property, as one does, and you walk through it, and you see her for the first time, and they had 3 camera crews filming this beautiful and organic first meeting with Oprah, and I saw her, and my brain just turned off. I was like, nope, I'm out. And she was like, Sean, 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 and I didn't know the protocol, like, Oprah, Oprah, Oprah. So I said nothing at all, but her hands were up. So I thought we were doing a high five, but we weren't. And then we were doing this weird clawed handshake, and we started rotating a circle with panicked eyes all the way around. They had to shut off the cameras for the first time in 1,000 interviews. If you ever see that episode where I see her for the first time, that was the second time. But a few minutes later, she makes you feel so comfortable, you'll tell her anything. So as they were breaking down the cameras, I turned to her and said, Oprah, I'm so disappointed with this interview. I really want to talk about going through depression, because it's so easy to hear all this research you've heard here this morning and be like, yeah, of course he's happy. He's a happiness researcher, right? His wife's a happiness researcher. His sister's a unicorn. And of course, Oprah's happy. Take your life, take your challenges, and then just add in all of her wealth and celebrity friends in a private jet. It's got to be easy in this life to be happier if you're Oprah. She said, Sean, I went through 2 years of depression at the height of my career while making the most money when beloved didn't do as well as I want to, and I shattered. I didn't want to go on living. If success at that altitude doesn't work, why do we keep thinking it's going to work at different altitudes? But then I turned around and I said, I went through 2 years of depression while I was at Harvard teaching the freshmen how not to go through depression. She turned back on the cameras. So we did a whole second hour that was so much deeper than the first, talking about how do you restart forward progress. The turning point for me, I now realize, was big potential. The turning point was, up to that point, I was good at checking off individual metrics in my life. So when I got depressed, I got this. I don't want to burden anyone else. I'll be there for other people, but I don't want to burden them. I went deeper in depression. The turning point is I had to turn to my 8 closest friends and family and said, I've been going through depression for 2 years. I have no idea how to get out of this, but I need your help. The groundswell of support was amazing. People were calling me, meeting up with me, emailing me, bringing me cupcakes. It's not why I did it, but they were amazing. But as soon as I did that, as soon as I told people I was dealing with depression, that mountain of depression in front of me dropped by 10 to 20% to come back to the hill study from earlier. Because now I'm not looking at that hill alone, I'm now climbing it with somebody else. And it turns out we created these reciprocal bonds that were the deepest bonds that I had during that period of time. And it's the reason I do the work now, as I was able to pull myself out of depression by leaning on the ecosystem of potential around us. That's great as an anecdote, but how do you replicate something like an anecdote? That's what I study, and what we found is a way to do so. At Facebook initially, but now we've done this worldwide cross-industry. We got teams. We have work routines when you come into work, fill out this log, like log in here, face detection here, fill out this form, then you can start your work. But we added one other work routine, because we know if your brain's positive, your team's success rate rises. So the managers led one positive work routine, which was when you first come to work, please, the very first thing you do is we ask you to write a 2-minute positive email or text message praising someone in this world. That's it, and try and do a different person for as long as you can. Around day 8, you think you run out of people, but then you start remembering that high school English teacher that mattered to you, or that friend you haven't seen in 2 years, or the person you used to work with, or that boss who was really great who gave you the first chance, or that ex who just had a baby. Turns out, oftentimes when we feel isolated and alone or feel like we don't have social connection, we have tons of it. Our brains are just not perceiving it, right? We're not perceiving that high school English teacher that had a huge impact upon us because we forgot about her because she's not within our immediate circle. But when you think about her, your brain just scanned for her. And then you send her a 2-minute positive email activating her, and then oftentimes she writes back to you. And it turns out your social connection deepens. If you do this for the next 3 days, for example, here's an example. I wrote to one of my high school English teachers, said, you were the reason I fell in love with reading. You're the reason I wrote a book. Thank you for changing my life. It took me 45 seconds to type. It took me longer to find that woman's email address online. When you have your first break this morning, everyone in here is going to pull out their smartphone. When you pull it out, you remember this moment. When you pull out your smartphone, just write a 2-minute text message praising or thanking someone in your life. Maybe somebody you don't normally thank. If you do it, I'm willing to bet for the majority of you, it'll be one of the best parts of the entire conference for you. And you'll get great emails back. Some of them will be like, are you drunk? It's 9 a.m. But other ones are, I like you like this. But it turns out other ones will be like, you've never said something like this. Or they'll actually write positive things back. If you do this for 3 days in a row, your brain literally gets addicted to it. You spend all day long thinking about how amazing you were for writing that email in the morning. Just like when you go for a run in the morning, you're like, I'm a runner. Even though this is the first time you've done it in a decade, you're like, I'm a runner. I totally deserve this pumpkin spice latte. You guys should be running too. I'm a runner, right? Like that's what happens to your brain. You start actually doing these positive, you actually raise your levels of praise and recognition unconsciously over the course of your day. Not the point of it. The point of it is if we do this for 21 days in a row without adding a single friend to your life, your social connection score, it's the perception of social connection, which is what matters. Perception of social connection rises to the top 20% of people worldwide. The reason that's important, doing the simple 2-minute habit a day using technology, turns out social connection is the greatest predictor of your long-term happiness. Social connection is the greatest predictor of your team's success rate. Social connection is the greatest predictor of resilience. And my last statistic is my favorite. We just found out social connection is as predictive of how long you will end up living as obesity, high blood pressure, or smoking. We fight so hard against the negative, and the negative looms larger and larger, so we feel like something simple, like thinking of 3 things I'm grateful for or writing a positive email, can't possibly have a huge impact upon my life. We did all this research to show you that you can actually do things like, if we get you to write that 2-minute positive email, we can extend your life as much as getting you to stop smoking. But if we get you to write the 2-minute positive email, your likelihood of stopping smoking rises dramatically. Turns out all this research comes down to 3 conclusions. Scientifically, our happiness is not fixed based upon our genes and our environment. If you create daily habits, we can move our levels of optimism from our genes. Second, happiness is contagious, as you saw with the smiling experiment earlier today that you failed miserably at. It turns out our brains are contagiously impacting other people all the time. And the final one is, the greatest advantage at overcoming the challenges you're going to be thinking about while you're here at the conference is a positive and engaged brain. So if that's true, what are we doing to actually increase our levels of positivity? To me, though, the final conclusion is the most important one, which is change is possible. I remember being that kid lying on the floor in a bathroom at Harvard, so depressed, breathing hurt. I had no idea that the story could say change so much that I'd be studying happiness someday, much less I get to come share any of this research with you here today at a conference. So from that kid, I just want to say thank you, but also to show you how much change is possible, that when we find a way of creating positive habits and finding a way of lighting up together instead of alone in the darkness, we can find a way of tipping a world away from negativity, stress, and uncertainty to see the meaning involved with our life. The fact that we just got to talk about happiness for 45 minutes surrounded by like-minded people is a gift, and we can use it to make this a better world for all the people that didn't get to be here right now. And all it takes is taking research that's only read on average by 7 people total and just bringing it to life. So thank you so much for letting me join you here today. And I hope you have a wonderful rest of the conference and can use these habits.
All right. Good morning. We're going to get things started here. Come on in, everybody. Exciting day 2. So yesterday, we unveiled a brand new product vision for the company, showed some incredible technology. Hopefully, you all got fired up about that. And for today's keynote, it's really all about turning that vision into reality and action. And so we've got a great lineup for you this afternoon. We're going to try and make it practical so that you walk away with real tangible things that you can go do to take this technology vision and put it into action. So for the rest of the program, we've got a little framework here for you. If we can jump ahead with the slides. Great. So the formula for taking vision and turning it into action is as follows. We're going to walk you through this today, starting with culture, technology, use cases, and partners. We've got a number of customers going to come up and talk about their use cases. We've got our chief customer officer is going to talk about the framework for putting those into place and extracting real business value. We've got our partners. We've got from our partner ecosystem here to walk through their solutions and what they're building on the platform. And to kick things off, we're going to talk about something that's perhaps the hardest thing to change, which is culture. And so I know this, you know, technology can sometimes feel easy, but adopting it can sometimes be a challenge. And so to talk about culture and how to make that happen, that shift happen inside your companies, please welcome to the stage Cindy Housen. Hi, Cindy.
Thank you, Scott. Yeah. Good morning. All right, so this side of the room is either really happy and not hungover, and this side is hungover and maybe really mindful and zen. So let's try that again. Good morning. Good morning. Thank you. So yesterday, you heard from visionary companies that are using data to transform their business, to improve customer service, and to compete in a really tough competitive environment. They painted a vision of the future that many of you aspire to, but are not even close to achieving. And I know that many of you really are so excited to hear about the technology. You're thinking, can we just get to the technology already? I'm excited about it too. But here's the thing. All of you tell me you want to be data-driven, but only 32% of you are data-driven. Why are we bothering to collect all this data if you're not using it? What's holding you back? Culture. You, your CEOs, often blame the culture on lack of being data-driven. Culture, it's such an elusive concept. It's made up by the people, the customs, the stories we tell, that's entrenched over years, decades even. It's very slow to change. Even how we dress reflects the culture. So are you formal, suit and tie, dress, skirt, from the Northeast, like me? Or are you a t-shirt and hoodies person, like many of my new colleagues in Silicon Valley? It's hard to change, but it starts with you, the business champion or the analytics change agent. How can you drive change in your organization? Because you can. And if I think about all the companies I've worked with over the years, the ones succeeding, as well as the ones floundering, what's their secret? It's often bringing in a change agent, sometimes externally, but often internally. So I'm thinking of a Fortune 100 consumer goods company who took a business person and put her in charge of business analytics. And guess what? She was afraid because many of the people she has to now lead talk technobabble. Technobabble. She's afraid of the technology, but what she understands is the business that is demanding more agility, demanding change. And understanding the business requirements is way more important than the technology. Or a telecom leader yesterday shared with me, he started in finance and kept complaining about the lack of data. So they now put him in charge of business analytics. So be careful what you complain about, because maybe you have to then go solve that problem. And sometimes it's about embedding those change agents throughout the organization. But I also think it's about incentives. And if you think in your organization, how do you approach change? And more importantly, how do you approach failure? Do you actually reward failure? Do you celebrate it? Now, we can't have catastrophic failures that go on for years and years. It's more about failing fast. And if I think about how IT is often measured on least cost to serve, there's no room for innovation. Even I know many of you here today are thinking about the technology choices you've made over the years. Did you make the wrong decision? So it slows our decision making, and it's not about the right decision for forever. It's what is the right decision for now, because what's state of the art keeps changing. And so if you think about your incentives, it's rewarding the failures, giving permission for that, but incentivizing the change agents to disrupt the business as well. The other aspect about fear is when you open up data access, is the way that fear can be used to punish people. So sometimes opening up access to data, some people don't like that. Because what is the data showing you? Is it bad news? Is it showing you that customer churn is too high? Or that travel expenses are over budget? Or that claims processing is too slow? So in the face of bad news, what do? Now, if you're responsible for that area, your job may be at risk. And maybe it should be. So my numbers were bad, maybe I'm going to hide those numbers, or I'm going to say they're wrong, they're not right. Or better yet, I know, let's fake the numbers. Let's add some filters so that my dashboard finally looks good. A customer of mine calls these vanity metrics. And part of faking the numbers is what's driven to some of the headline news with Wells Fargo, Veterans Affairs Hospital, or even VW, faking their emission test results. So sometimes it does mean that a person's job is at risk, but what I want you to think about is what's creating that resistance to change. And as a CIO said to me recently, what's worked for us for the last 100 years will not help us survive even the next 3. And recent findings is showing that this rate of creative destruction is accelerating, where half of today's Fortune 500 companies will be replaced in less than 10 years. It used to take 25 years for that rate of destruction. So which side of the equation do you want to be on? And I think about this culture and this fear and the lives that we're impacting, the people, you're asking them to change. And I worry that we're throwing so much technology out there without considering the impact on people. So you can lay out a vision for the future, but you have to consider the people impact. And this starts with one person I like his work, Jim Collins from Good to Great. It's about making sure you have the right people on the bus. That can be your core team, but it also could be the change agents, the champions. Sometimes it's external. Some consulting, or also embedding these people, the data and analytics champions, throughout the business units. It's also about upskilling, helping those report developers who are afraid that they will not be relevant going forward, and I do believe they will be less relevant. But it's about helping them upskill to become better communicators, data storytellers. And I want you investing not only in data literacy, but data fluency. So it's not just about reading data, it's actually thinking data for a more fact-driven world. So with that foundation, then I want you to think about how is data relevant down to the individual person, or as I like to call it, WIFM. What is in it for me? And to understand what is in it for me, the best organizations, they will take somebody who understands data, and they may figuratively walk in that person's shoes. Call center operator, data person sits in the call center to understand what that call center operator needs. Or yesterday, you heard from one of our customers, DRC, so data in education, taking student test scores. What's the WIFM for a teacher? It's about meeting the needs of the students. It's not about the data. It's about the students. That is the teacher's WIFM. Or at Walmart, you heard about the merchandisers trying to get the pricing and the inventory at a very granular level just right so they can better compete with all retailers and survive. That's the merchandiser's WIFM, right pricing, right inventory. So if you think about getting the right culture and the right people combined with a really powerful technology, we think that is the winning formula for success. And here to talk about the technology is Chief Technology Officer and co-founder Amit Prakash.
Thank you, Cindy.
Good morning, Amit. So, Amit.
Yeah.
You know, we talk about change. You guys got me to change literally my career after 17 years to come to a startup. You haven't got me to change my dress, so nice t-shirt.
Thank you. I love it.
I don't know if you'll ever get me to wear a t-shirt, but I feel the need to try to change and cross-fertilize, be a change agent. So I have a present for you, a tie. Now, I don't know, you clearly can't wear it today, but I know some of our formal customers in the Northeast, New York, and Boston are going to be looking for that when you come visit them, as long as Ajit doesn't steal it from you.
Now, Cindy, I'm really grateful for this, but, you know, this would be the fastest way for me to lose credibility as a CTO.
No. Thanks, Amit.
All right. So, what an important discussion about culture. You know, what we have come to realize that culture is really the foundation of success for any organization. And the cultural value that I've come to appreciate the most is give your 100% to whatever you're doing, except when you're giving blood. No, jokes aside, I'm here to talk about a topic that I'm most passionate about. It's really the secret sauce behind ThoughtSpot. It's the reveal of the magic. This is what makes us unique. When you look at that demo for the first time in ThoughtSpot, and you're thinking to yourself, how is this happening? This is the reason. We've built our system on the principles of distributed computing and made a really, really different choice than any of the other products in the space to go build a data platform, a really powerful data platform, before building a product. So geek out with me a little bit, I'm going to talk to you about the secret sauce behind the product. And Cindy talked about what happens when you're in an organization with the right tools but not the right culture. Let me tell you a little bit about what happens when you have the right culture but not the right tools with the right architecture. Recently, I was talking to a data engineer in one of the financial institutions in Manhattan, an investment bank that manages hundreds of billions of dollars, and they were about a week away from deployment of ThoughtSpot in production. And he was so passionate about it, he said, "Amit, you know, we are managing so much money. There's so many opportunities worth millions of dollars that we are not able to catch simply because we don't have the visibility. And if ThoughtSpot can even catch one of them, that'll be an amazing outcome and a huge victory." And sure enough, a week later, I hear that in a mere 30-minute orientation, one of the business users casually searching through their data found an insight that's actually saving them more than $1 million a year, which was essentially a discrepancy in their lending rates. So, and this story is not unique. I can talk to you about investment banking, I can talk to you about insurance, I can talk to you about retail, manufacturing, procurement. You give me a vertical, I'll tell you a story like that. Magical things happen when you can unleash the curiosity of people who are most intimately familiar with your business. And the interesting thing is that none of these organizations with these stories happened had any dearth of so-called modern BI tools. They had plenty of licenses of Tableau, OrClick, or Power BI, but it took the simplicity and the scale of ThoughtSpot architecture to unlock the value of that kind. And we've been doing this for 7.5 years. Over the last 5.5 years that we've been in the market, I've talked to hundreds of customers. And the conversation always starts at the same place, the place of skeptical curiosity. They tell me, "I've been promised this before. You know, this search-based thing doesn't work." Many times people said that, "I've got a solution like that that's going to democratize data, and it hasn't worked for me." Some even tell me that they have seen this in some other product like Power BI or Tableau Ask Data, and they've played, and they don't think search is very useful. And my response to them, that of course it's not useful, because they have taken all the visible parts of search and AI-driven analytics, kind of the tip of the iceberg, and put that in the product, and made none of the investments that was required to build the architecture to support it, to make it actually work. Not all search is equal. So with that, let me tell you about the architectural decisions that we made after a detour. When Ford decided to transform the automotive industry, and they wanted to build a car that almost anyone making a decent living could have, they had to go and invent moving assembly line. And this not only transformed the automotive industry, it transformed the manufacturing industry as a whole. When Elon Musk was contemplating building the car of the future, he had to first go and innovate in the battery space. And this has resulted in innovation across the industry. Now, if you juxtapose that with the realities of building a startup, you're faced with a small team, limited amount of investment money, and a very short window to go to the market, right? And so what you're faced with is essentially the same choice that Morpheus gave to Keanu Reeves, Neo, in the movie Matrix. You can take the easy route, the blue pill, and you can try to build a product based on what exists in the market and quickly putting together with existing components a product that's a minimum viable product you get to market. And in most cases, that may be the right decision. But you can take the hard choice and take the red pill, and the chances are that you will run out of money even before you have a product out, right? But every once in a while, a company comes along that makes the red pill work. And when they make it work, then transformational things happen. Entire industry transforms. Product landscape changes. So when you see the picture of two idiots smiling on the left side of the screen, These are the two idiots who were contemplating that kind of transformation about 7.5 years ago. And the hypothesis was simple. Could we build a product in analytics space that any business user could use without having to sit through 3 days of training? Could we build a product that was fast and scalable enough that you could put all of enterprise data, hundreds of billions of rows, and you could still work with it without putting everybody in a sandbox of pre-computation and cubes? And could we build a product that was smart enough that you had to put the least amount of effort, least input, and you could get all the insights that you needed at the right time? And so we iterated over many different choices, many different interfaces, and finally converged with this search-based interface. But the difference was that it was not any other search. Unlike Google or Yahoo or Bing, we are not going and looking for things that already exist and simply retrieving information. We have to interpret what the question is asking and then go and compute it, essentially conjure the answer up from thin air. And unlike Google, we cannot give you simply 10 blue links when you ask for how much revenue did I have last year and say you decide which of these 10 answers are correct, right? So we had to come up with a new architecture to make it work. And essentially, three things over here that we had to do. First was we had to go and extract every possible string from the database. This included column names, values, whether it's customer names, product names, cities, zip codes, and put that in an index in such a way that under a second, you could be sending thousands of queries to this index, and within 10 milliseconds or so, it will be searching through hundreds of millions of strings and giving you back answers about what matches, what is the most relevant thing, so that we can make sense of essentially what is the question asking. The second thing we had to do is build a dynamic compilation and auto-completion engine that constructs language on the fly based on the terminology of your organization, which could be column names, synonyms, it could be values in there. It basically constructs a language based on the strings that you care about, and then dynamically builds the compilation and auto-completion engine. And then the third thing was machine learning behind search, a new kind of machine learning behind the search that's constantly learning from what the users are asking, what sort of auto-completion suggestions they are picking up, what are they liking, what are they not liking. In the same way that when you go on Google and you search for pictures of dogs, and if you don't like the result, you go to the next one and you ask for pictures of puppies, and then Google can make the correlation that dogs and puppies are similar things, and when somebody asks for dogs, you can search for puppies. In a similar way, we are constantly learning from your searches, and this makes not only our search much better, entire product much better. When we give you insights in Spot IQ, that's the thing that's powering the machine learning. So having made the choice of search, now we were faced with the fact that search interface is not supposed to return answers in minutes. It's supposed to return in search time, which is a few seconds. And we had this grand vision of putting hundreds of billions of rows in there. So we had to build a system or find a system where you could ask a question and compute the answer by going through hundreds of billions of rows and come back under a second. And so what I did was I went and benchmarked pretty much everything under the sun, every open source project, every commercial product that I could lay my hands on to see if we could get this kind of performance. And nothing, I mean nothing came close to it, even by an order of magnitude. The only thing that was working was if I had loaded the data already in my program, in memory, in the right data structures, and I had written a hand-optimized C++ code to compute the answer, that's the only thing that would actually give me the answer in 400, 500 milliseconds. So, and even moving from there in C++ to Java doing the same thing, performance dropped by 10x. Going to any other database, the performance dropped by 100x or so. And going to most of the Apache Hadoop-based kind of things, it dropped by 1,000x. So that's when we decided that we had to build our own distributed in-memory compute engine, which we like to call Falcon, where as your query comes in, dynamically we generate C++ code. This as close as we can make it to hand-optimize C++ code, we compile that, and we run it on the data that's already there in the data structures, and then compute the answer. So with those two choices, our choice of architecture arrived. So the first thing we had to do is build this distributed cluster manager. And what this is essentially it takes control of tens or hundreds of machines that's needed for you to be able to run this compute. This is almost an orchestration layer for the cluster. And we already talked about Falcon, which is our in-memory calculation engine. Then we invented this new kind of search engine, which indexes every possible string from the database and then makes meaning out of the queries that you're asking as well as giving suggestions. And then we also invented a new kind of AI engine and built that. And then, of course, we had to build everything that a modern BI solution is supposed to do, so that as well. So in 2012, with a few million dollars in the bank and a less than 10% engineering team, we ventured on this journey. And the results speak for themselves when we talk about companies like Walmart. Yesterday, I was talking to Heidi. And for the first time, we were able to make Item 360 a reality for them, where teams from merchandising department, finance department, e-commerce department could all look at all the items and everything about them. They could get SKU-level analytics at the tip of their finger. They could do dynamic pricing. We gave more visibility to their execs than ever before, and we allowed them to do markdown optimization at SKU level that simply was not possible before with the existing compute. And we are not stopping there. We are continuing to run the innovation train and invest in our platform. More than 70% of our customers today host ThoughtSpot in cloud. So we realize that making it work better in cloud, making it cheaper to run in cloud, is a huge priority for us. And we are already doing a lot of different things to actually reduce the cost with in-memory compression, with better use of native storage formats in cloud. We are seeing a lot of good results, and I'm pretty confident that by mid-next year, we would be able to reduce the cost of running ThoughtSpot in any of the public cloud by a factor of two. With increased adoption of Kubernetes and orchestration frameworks like EKS and GKE, we are investing in Kubernetes, and what we are seeing is that it's making our customers' life much simpler, particularly when they care about a lot about security, when they want to bring their own operating system in cloud and still run our software on top of it. Once we have the support, it will make it really easy. And we think this will be available. We are already running some of the POCs. The engineering team is running it. We think sometime before mid-next year, we'll have support for both EKS and GKE. And yesterday, you saw our vision about disrupting consumption by hyper-personalized feed. So we are building a new personalization engine that's going to be powered by similar kind of machine learning algorithms that's been powering our search and homepage and everything else. And this will power consumption. And we are not stopping there. We have a new product line that I'm sure you're going to love and we already see a lot of excitement about. We like to call it Embrace, where we are opening up our data platform to send queries to other databases. So for years now, customers have been telling us that we love the ThoughtSpot experience. We would love to do it everywhere. The only thing is that I can't possibly be moving data from all the different sources into your system. And what we've been telling them is that it's simply not possible, it defies physics, to be able to do the kind of experience, build the kind of experience we are building for you without putting the data in our system. But I'm very happy to report that our engineering teams have been working really hard for the last 2 years, and we are already generally available live with an integration with Snowflake, and we have an alpha version of integration with Amazon Redshift, and before mid-next year, we will have integration with Google BigQuery as well. thank you. So if you haven't checked it out, go check out our integration with Snowflake. And to show how it works, we are going to do a demo. So Snigdha.
Thank you so much, Amit. Introducing ThoughtSpot Embrace for Snowflake. An easy way to get your data, to get ThoughtSpot to run over your data without having to move any existing databases or any additional data modeling that your traditional analytical tool would require you to. With ThoughtSpot Embrace, all you need to do is connect to a cloud warehouse, and in today's demo's case, it's Snowflake. Bring in the tables, bring in the columns you want to run your search on, and voila, use ThoughtSpot. So to create a connection so that our end users can have access to the data, all you need to do is add your credentials for that specific cloud warehouse, and you're done. To see that, let's see an initial list of configurations, which is constantly growing as we speak. Our main aim is to let you connect to data to any of the popular public warehouses, on-prem relational databases, or marketing and sales solutions. Since we've already created the connection for this demo, let's go and take a look at all the tables that exist in the Snowflake database. So for today's demo, we'll be taking a look at a media data set which is very similar to Comcast, Netflix, Hulu. It basically tells you which programs worked, which did not, which sales and campaign marketing worked and which failed, and the most important question that each one of us cares about, which customer left, when, and why. So to take a look at the database in Snowflake, so right now this is the Snowflake database that we are looking at. And these are the tables that we can take a look at the column from, data type from, and even sample the rows, sample the data that is coming through. I would also like to add, this is not all. Once this gets connected, you will see a very familiar data management console where you can change the name of your columns, add description, or add a synonym, which is very particular to your company, so that they can get a very personalized user experience. And not just this. We also bring in the schema details and joins from Snowflake into ThoughtSpot. So as you guys saw, in how some very quick, easy steps, we are already connected, and we are already ready to go and search on ThoughtSpot. So let's take a look at the shows that were popular in this last summer by the number of customers. Let's say last 6 months. And of course, I am very sure that's going to be my favorite Game of Thrones that wins the race. And as you can see, however significant the question is, however simple ThoughtSpot made it to look like, I would like to emphasize that there are a lot of tables, a lot of joins at play here. And I would want to also go to Query Visualizer just to show you how many tables and joins were in there. And it is only with ThoughtSpot that you did not need to do any of those data modeling while ThoughtSpot took care of it for you. So this is how we are bringing in search database experience and AI-driven analytics to Snowflake. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Snigdha. That was wonderful. And so now, to talk about our new form, new form partnership with Snowflake, let me invite Harsha from Snowflake. Harsha, come on up on stage. Thank you so much for coming here.
Thank you for having me.
So tell us a little bit about yourself.
Sure. So my name is Harsha. I've been in the data management space for the past 20 years. I've been with Snowflake for 2.5 years. I'm responsible for our technology ecosystem at Snowflake. So that's everything from client drivers, APIs, all the way to engagement with our most strategic partners like ThoughtSpot. And usually what I'm doing when I'm working with partners is trying to move beyond kind of simple integrations and really looking for optimizations around performance, security, ease of use, things like that.
Very cool. So what sort of benefit are you seeing from ThoughtSpot for your existing Snowflake customers?
Seeing a lot of benefits. So one of the key, you know, value props of Snowflake, or what really differentiates us, is our ability to separate storage and compute. And there's a whole slew of things that are involved there, but what it means is effectively in-database processing is extremely optimized with Snowflake. So, you know, with modern architectures like this, you really want to bring the processing down to where the data lives. You don't want to be pulling the data out. I think we've been talking about that for a while now. So with Embrace, they've really embraced this approach. Sorry for the pun. But, you know, they're sending all the queries down into Snowflake where the data resides, right? So the old way of having, like, hourly feeds that are updating a cache or another database, that goes away. The business users are no longer running queries on data that is 30 minutes or an hour stale, which is important now as data's, you know, the amount of data is growing and the speed that's coming in. So instead, they're getting more relevant and more current data, you know, immediately.
Awesome. So how can people experience ThoughtSpot and Snowflake together?
There's a couple different ways. So we have been working with the ThoughtSpot team on a couple of, or a few joint solutions. So actually, Kevin Miller, who's our VP of Solution Partners, will be coming out to go a little bit more detail on those solutions. But another way is through something we call Partner Connect. It's a portal in Snowflake that allows you to instantly provision partner free trials, and not only provision them, but instantly connect them to your Snowflake account, all in a matter of seconds.
Awesome. Anything else you'd like to share with them?
Well, I'll just a little bit more on the Partner Connect piece. I mean, you can see we're here with ThoughtSpot actually nice in bright white. but the idea behind this is, you know, anybody who's looking to get started with ThoughtSpot, you click on the ThoughtSpot button. Within 5 to 10 seconds, you've got an account spun up for you. There's no email activation. None of that happens. Everything happens through a back-end API. And you're up and running, exploring your data, you know, within, you know, less than 30 seconds.
Awesome. Thank you so much for coming and spending time with us and talking to us.
Thank you, guys.
Up next, I would like to invite our partners from Google Cloud, specifically Naveen Punjabi, who runs the alliances for Google. Naveen, come on up on stage. Thank you so much, Naveen, for coming here.
Thanks for having
Google is such an amazing company. I've got so much respect for them, not only because they paid for my house through the stock options, but also because I learned so much at Google while I was there in such an innovative company. So tell us, how Google has such a big investment in cloud, and how the customers are experiencing their cloud journey with Google?
Yeah, if you think about it, Amit, the cloud conversation with customers has changed quite a bit. If you talk a few years ago, the conversation that we were having with customers was more about cost optimization, TCO analysis that goes into the consideration of cloud. But now the way customers are looking at it is thinking about how does cloud bring in the capabilities that help them transform their businesses, fundamentally transform their business workflows. We have a large number of customers who are in healthcare, processing exabytes of data at scale and trying to accelerate early detection of diseases, accelerate the cycle of drug discovery that it takes, and it's fundamentally shifting the industry, and it's happening all across. It's happening in financial services, it's happening in media and all of that. So what Google is doing in that journey is basically bringing three set of capabilities to the market. What we are doing is, at the foundation layer, we are bringing a very scalable, reliable, secure data center infrastructure that customers can run their workloads, scale up, scale down, at scale. On top of that, we are providing a digital transformation platform. And what that allows you to do is store, manage, process data at scale. It includes a bunch of our AI and ML services combined with it. It has an application development platform that allows you to build applications for a cloud-native format. And on top of that, what we are being very prescriptive about is, in specific industries, building solutions that customers are looking for in the mm-hmm. cloud so that their journey to the cloud is eased. So that's where our head is at, and we are executing on that.
Awesome. Very cool. And I think analytics and machine learning is such a core part of Google Cloud strategy. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, at the core of it, what Google wants to do is be the best platform for running analytics workloads. And while doing that, being open. I think mm-hmm. those are the two big aspects. We know the world is generating a lot more data than ever before. But if you think about it, many enterprises are not able to analyze and derive insights out of mm-hmm. that data. And we fundamentally believe the challenge there is the complexity of the big data systems that they have in place today. And so we, in data analytics and AI specifically, are being very pragmatic about building systems that allow you to process structured, unstructured data sets in a very easy fashion, in a very seamless fashion, that means serverless, and at scale. That's what Google is good at. That's what we do. And I also mentioned, and a good example of that, for example, is BigQuery, right? It's a mm-hmm. fully managed data warehouse platform. You go to the GCP console. All you have to do is click on BigQuery. There's a console in front of you. You load the data in, and you are able to write queries against it and derive insights. You're not thinking about provisioning of clusters and capacity planning and all of that, right? So mm-hmm. that's the nature of cloud. The other aspect that we're looking at is bringing intelligence where the user is at. Mm-hmm. And another example is making AI accessible by doing allowing model creation within BigQuery. Mm-hmm. So customers can create ML models inside BigQuery using a SQL interface. And it's empowering the data analyst to be a data science, to do the data science workload, right? Yeah. So that's our focus. I also talked about being open. One of the things that we want to do is solutions that customers are using today, we want them to run best on Google Cloud. Mm. So we announced partnerships with a key set of ecosystem partners like Confluent, Redis Labs, MongoDB earlier in the year to offer managed services on Google Cloud in a much more seamless and frictionless fashion. Customers can go in the console and deploy those services. We announced our partnership with our friends at Snowflake as well, beginning of the year, so we are really excited about it. In general, that's what we are doing, being open and being operating at scale.
Awesome. So we just announced that we are going to have integration with BigQuery sometime next year. What benefits do you think BigQuery users will get from using ThoughtSpot?
Oh, we are really excited about it. When I look at the customer journey, what customers are doing today, they're putting a lot of investments in the cloud. They're bringing a lot of data into the cloud. But I think the impact of the cloud hasn't reached the end, the last mile, the business mm-hmm. user yet, right? So the business user still has to process a lot of data. That requires a bit of work.
Yeah.
They have to move the data. And with Embrace for Google BigQuery, what essentially is going to happen, it's going to bring the scale of Google BigQuery along with the capabilities of being able to run search and AI-driven queries within BigQuery. And so it brings empowers the business user in a fashion like it's never before. And we are really looking forward for it. And customers are really excited about it as well.
Very cool. I know already a lot of customers are asking for it, so I'm excited as well. Thank you so much
looking
for coming and spending
that.
Time with us.
Likewise.
Thank you again.
Thanks.
So now that you have got culture down, technology down, the question remains, how do you get the maximum business value out of this? And to talk about that, I cannot think of a better person than our Chief Customer Officer, Anuj Gulati. Anuj, come on up on stage. Thank you so much, Anuj. Yeah. What are you grateful for?
I'm grateful for you writing the code to build this product.
Good answer. Correct answer.
Hi, morning, everybody. Seems a little thinned out this morning out here. As the chief customer officer, the role of my organization, which is the professional services as well as the customer service organization, is to actually drive massive business outcomes, right? And what are massive business outcomes? An example of that could be, take a retailer like Hagar, who we've heard from. How do we enable them to actually go ahead and manage their new product performance? How do we help them improve their fulfillment rates at their key customers, making sure that we minimize their inventory while making sure that we have service levels maintained at a level that they actually want to. If you take a pharma company, how do we identify a sweet spot for cross-selling, whether it's geographically based, whether it's age-based, whether it's gender-based? You know, these are the kind of outcomes where we've delivered over hundreds of engagements out here at ThoughtSpot. I'll talk a little bit about the framework, but before we do that, maybe we could just roll an introductory video to give you a sense and a sampling of the kind of work that we've done with the customers. So if we could roll that video, please.
Before ThoughtSpot, what our analytics environment looked like was very limited, very controlled. I wouldn't even go so far as to call it analytics. It was more reporting, operational reporting, not very actionable.
Everything was BI reports built custom. If somebody had a question, it would be months before they could see the change.
If someone wants a change to a report right now, they have to engage a developer. In terms of the data that we have, it's massive. It's years deep. Until now, we really haven't been able to access that data and make as valuable business use of it.
Without ThoughtSpot, I think I wouldn't have the flexibility often to really provide the answers that I need to give.
For some years, we've been looking to try and find we called it Google for data. One of the things that we were really impressed by with ThoughtSpot was the simplicity of interface. The fact that the technology had been designed from search up rather than a BI solution with some search capability put over the top.
The ability to empower the users to get insight out of the data, I think it's very powerful. I think this will be very extremely intuitive for them to understand that they can easily have quicker time to market and really affect customer experience in a big way.
So with ThoughtSpot, what we're able to do is give our business users more freedom of access to data that they haven't had before.
I didn't have to invest a lot of time to learn every single thing. I could just get started.
I think the biggest benefit is how many users we were able to reach and how small of a time. The biggest thing with ThoughtSpot now is I rolled out some of the answers and analysis to these branch staff, which are 2,000 more users, really easily. I didn't have to worry about licensing.
Our searches have really surged from like 6,000 back in June to 14,000 in the month of October.
There's those aspects like Spot IQ, where it can tell you things that you might already know, but also the things that you haven't realized yet.
Now, we're asking the questions. The machine is returning to us lots of information beyond the initial question.
We've started implementing Spot IQ. It helps us to play even around more with the data and generate insights out of the data.
There is no way I give an analyst an Excel sheet of a million rows and ask them to find the insights and then figure out whether they're valid or not.
You can take the answer to a question into a meeting or into a working group. And if there are further questions, it's really easy just to ask those of ThoughtSpot at the time. So you can do real-time analysis and real-time drill down into the data.
What we have in Nationwide is what I describe as a big human middleware, and that is a lot of people between the data and the insight. And I think ThoughtSpot will give us the ability to reduce that human middleware and re-divert some of that cost and effort into better decision-making.
One of the reasons Milwaukee Tool like to partner with ThoughtSpot is because of the scalability. I mean, we're growing at 15 to 20% plus a year. The amount of data we're collecting is growing exponentially. So partnering with a company like ThoughtSpot and their ability to grow with us and consume and absorb all that data and render it in near real time to our end users, that was a very good focus for us to match our needs.
The speed is a massive factor for people. Just the ability to instantly type how many mortgages did I sell yesterday and know, I think is amazing.
If anything is out of inventory, we're able to react much faster than having to wait weeks or months. With ThoughtSpot, they are able to do all that within one tool in a matter of seconds.
The days of waiting for, you know, 6 months for a report, in today's world, that delay can cost you a $1 million contract.
We're seeing constant innovation, which we think is bringing ideas and insights to our organization that perhaps we've not even thought about before.
We can move so much faster now when the business moves with capabilities that ThoughtSpot allows us to do.
What do you guys think? So, firstly, immensely grateful to all our customers that have actually partnered with us to help them unlock their business value. Thank you so much. And then the ask is for all the folks that are prospects out here and considering us, let us help you be part of this journey as well. So thank you. Let's talk a little bit about, you know, the framework that we have identified and put in place to actually unleash this business value that we're talking about. Essentially, I would, you know, bring it down to four considerations, right? The first consideration is actually identifying the right use case. And, you know, let's start off with, you know, what's a use case? Actually, it might be better to start off with what's not a use case, right? So if you think about an area that you've decided to go ahead and unleash business value, right? It could be sales analytics, it could be supply chain costs, it could be improving the supplier risk in your supply base, right? That's a domain area. That's not really a use case, right? What we really need to get down to is there are terms in the industry like user stories and user journeys, and we've got to understand how does the user, how does she interact with the data? How does she converse with the data? What kind of decisions are they making, right? Where are the constraints that prevent a persona or a user from actually unlocking business value? Once you get down to that level of detail, then it becomes very easy to create a solution, a sticky solution, that will continue to get used and unlock business value, right? What we don't want to, and we've learned through this, right? What we don't want is just another me-too incremental solution that mimics another dashboard, for example. And we say, okay, we've got a few other features out here. You guys have something that is really, really transformational. Let's use it to actually drive transformation and not an incremental me-too solution, right? So that's the first piece, which is identifying the business use case. Once we do that, you know, the focus really needs to shift to how do you design a user experience? And I think we've heard about this yesterday in spades, where we're taking on a new journey around personalization. But really, the key is how do you design a user experience that actually takes into account, you know, what I call are a couple of things, right? Is the curiosity index of the user, and also the data literacy of the user. Do you have users that are actually passive consumers of pin boards and dashboards? Or do they actually interact with the data in a meaningful manner? And it's okay, right? You're not gonna get a set of users that are gonna start off in every organization, you know, interacting with the data and drilling down and doing all kinds of great stuff. But you've got to design the solution taking into account the maturity of the data literacy in your organization. That's really, really key. The other thing that we found that is very useful and very impactful is if you make the data easy to understand, right? And what I mean by that is, you know, have the metadata that is in a format that is easy to consume for a user. If you're in a sales organization and you're a person that's trying to understand what sales is, Don't put the user in a position to try to understand what the schema looks like in the source data. Make it easy. Call it sales data, if you will. So that's really the second piece. Once we've actually designed, we found a good use case, a sticky use case that is transformational, we've designed a use case taking into account the user profile and the data literacy of the user. The third piece is to make sure that you stay engaged with the end user in their journey, right? Let's make sure that the journey is as awesome and as comfortable as the outcome itself. Let's remove all that friction. And I would submit to you, it's not complicated, but it requires execution. And there are two things that need to get done. First, let's go ahead and educate the users. Start off with simple 2-hour training classes. They don't need to be two days. There are custom videos that we've built for customers. They're all available. Oh, and by the way, awesomeness is here. You have a new onboarding experience in the product right now where you don't have to step away. So let's design that user experience. Let's stick with them. Secondly, as they start that journey of consuming this data, let's also understand, in a broader sense, how people are actually consuming this information. And what I mean by that is, we've got the instrumentation in the product today, and we've got some customers that are using it really well, and others have the potential to do a lot more, right? And what I mean by that is, wake up in the morning, take a look at your pin boards, and understand how many searches are being conducted. How many weekly active users do you have? If you've got weekly usage or monthly usage, is that in sync with your business cycle as such? Right? Let's take a look at what is the retention rate, which is if you had 100 users that you trained 4 weeks ago, do you have 30% of them coming back, or is it 50% of them coming back to use the product? Right? So all that instrumentation is there, so let's just make sure we stay with the users and we go ahead and monitor what the usage is. And then finally, once you have a point solution, right, that you have identified that has delivered gobs of value, let's make sure we've got a portfolio of use cases that you can go ahead and execute. And let's create something transformational. Let's not have one product or one solution and then scratch our heads and try to think about what we want to do. I can submit to you, we've got customers that have got plans for the next 2 years, and they've actually aligned what they want to do with ThoughtSpot with their corporate initiatives. So let's do that. We've got the ability to do that. I would say, maybe as a way to start, if you're new to this, is one of the approaches we've taken is, let's start off with a customer 360. And what is a customer 360? Let's take an example of a bank. If you're a bank and you've got customers and they're using your credit cards and you want to get a sense of what kind of business you do? What kind of business does this customer do with the bank? Do I have the mortgage business, right? When they travel, do I have the foreign exchange business? So you can start off with that. That's a customer 360 perspective. Other customers have started off on the merchandising side, which is around product 360, right? How is this product selling? Which geographies, all the other questions that you've heard of. So there's a product 360 centricity use case. And then finally, you have something that's a supplier 360. I'm just using these as examples, right? What parts are being bought with the biggest variances in unit pricing across your supplier base? Where is the risk, right? Now, this is what we've got teed up out here over the next few minutes are examples of customer 360, supplier 360, and product 360. And we just wanted to share some customer stories and some of those examples with you. So with that, let's start off with the first one, which is a customer 360. And let me introduce you to Adi Jayaraman, who actually runs our customer success organization in North America and Asia Pacific. So Adi, welcome.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. You hear me okay? Awesome. So it's my honor to be here in front of you. Thank you so much. As Anuj mentioned, I'm from the customer success team. So what that means is my customers are my lifeline. My customers are the reason for my professional existence. Having said this, let's get into customer 360. Yeah? So yesterday, Sudhish spoke about in his keynote this opportunity that a lot of you have as companies to create a very personalized experience for each and every one of your customers. My question to you all, are you able to hear me okay? Awesome. My question to you all is, how does that personalized experience for every of your customers happen without a customer 360 platform? Yeah? So let's talk about what customer 360 means for us at ThoughtSpot. It means a holistic view of each and every customer's experience as she goes through the life cycle of her engagement with ThoughtSpot. Each and every customer's experience across the life cycle. Let me just go down a step further. What that means for us is for each customer, what is the opportunity pipeline over the next 2 quarters? What marketing campaigns have we hit them with? Yeah? What have they bought from us? How many instances? Which versions? Then we get on to saying, how many open trouble tickets? What feature, Jira feature requests? Then we get on to saying, critical adoption metrics per use case per customer. And most importantly, customer sentiment measured by NPS. It's a holistic view across all these data domains, ladies and gentlemen. It's a holistic view, and it's a granular view at the level of every customer. Holistic and granular, not holistic or granular. So how does that benefit us at ThoughtSpot? Every time any of us is reaching to any of our customers, this could be sales, this could be folks from marketing, customer success, finance, executive management, everyone has the same 360 view of that customer. It's a 360 view of that particular customer. It's the same view. Yeah? Now, very quickly, is it easy or difficult to get this done? Well, obviously, it's not very easy. I'll give you just one example. So for this one customer that I personally was involved in putting together this customer 360 use case, we had to bring in 11 fact tables and join them through 4 shared dimension tables. I'm not here to talk about the technical complexity of this. If any of you has more questions, please feel free to catch me after this. I am generally available. So just catch me, and I'd love to have this discussion with you. The only point I will make is that this is a nightmare in the world of legacy BI. With ThoughtSpot, you can do it like that. So we're not going to talk about this now. Instead, what I'd like to do is actually walk you through the shoes of one of our customers in Australia, Suncorp. Suncorp is a leading insurance provider there. And share with Suncorp here, our customer here, share with you the story of what Suncorp was able to achieve with this kind of a customer 360 platform. Before we do that, could we roll the video, please?
Suncorp is both an insurer and a bank, and we service close to 9 million customers across Australia and New Zealand.
The challenge before was, if I wanted a report or if I wanted data or information, I would have to request it, I would have to wait, and that wait could be days, weeks, months sometimes, depending on what you wanted to see.
We were stuck in this cycle of increasing our own demand, basically.
Data is much more accessible now, and it's quite easy to use. Activities which would have previously taken weeks on weeks are now being turned around in a matter of days.
It's given me as a user now a sense of control in the outcome. So if I have an idea, if I want to see something, I can go and actually do it straight away.
What I did once I was comfortable with ThoughtSpot was created a pin board that replaced all of my manual reporting.
Being able to identify outliers and be able to focus in on them to understand what sort of things are driving some of the issues that we're experiencing.
Teams that didn't have any reporting in place were able to quickly generate stuff. So got a backlog down from, I think it was about 1,200 hours to 200 hours in the WIP, just by having that visibility over it.
For us as a business, a lot of reporting is just an Excel dump of data. So to be able to create a list that's similar to that is very basic, right? But the ability to transform that into graphs or graphical information, to be doing that at a flick of a button almost sometimes, and a couple little change of fields, is great. It gives people the ability to see and track results with a little bit more specificity than just seeing a data dump of a list of things that aren't done or are done.
Being able to type in natural language to ask a question that has some complexity to it and return an answer. Being able to narrow your context from a data point of view, indicate your intent in what you're searching on, and then dive into Spot IQ, narrow it further, come back out and then iterate through. It's a massively fast way to build answers and insights.
Rather than people having to understand just the structure of the data, people are beginning to understand the meaning of the data as they get more proficient in the use of ThoughtSpot.
The biggest thing for us has been the verse last year data. Being able to predict or at least look at what we were doing this time last year to see what might be coming for the financial year, that's been a huge benefit. Before, I could probably have done that on the manual reporting. It probably would have taken me a week to figure out how.
I was thinking about how this particular business looks at closing some of their claims in their portfolio as a business. So I ran that through in the query, you know, was able to pick out the fields that I needed to generate this report, and found that we had, you know, 500 or 600 claims that we could have closed that are still open that the guys are working on, highlighting that inefficiency within the business.
We're able to build one environment now which can hold hundreds of millions of records, which are aggregating on the fly in sub-seconds.
To be able to use the search functionality and for it to be able to predict what I want to filter in or out, and to look for those keywords for someone who isn't as technical like myself, has been of great value to me. It almost sort of teaches me as I'm using the product.
For me, SpotIQ is the whole piece. The building of searches and pin boards is great, but where you get your insights is through SpotIQ.
For Suncorp's strategy of digitization and digital transformation, data analytics are at the very center of it.
Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome Tim Johnson. He's the head of insurance business operations at Suncorp. Tim, it's an honor to share this podium with you. Welcome to Beyond. Could you tell our audience a little bit more about Suncorp and what your specific role there is?
Absolutely. I mean, the key question on my mind is really who thought that a mechanical bull and karaoke last night was a good idea? And I'm blaming Dylan, but I can't see you because of the lights. Suncorp is one of the largest insurers in Australia and New Zealand. And my role in that is running middle and back office operations for the insurance business. You saw some of my staff on the screen there, in that role was sort of the key sponsor for bringing ThoughtSpot on board.
Thank you. So Tim, talk to us about what putting in this customer 360 use case has meant for Suncorp, but more specifically your end customers.
Yeah, well, as an example, you saw Cheryl on the video there. That's out of our settlements team in Brisbane. Putting the sort of data that the frontline teams now have access to into ThoughtSpot, has enabled Cheryl to as a frontline user to be able to actually access daily updated data that shows her exactly what's happening in her queue to her claims, where the outliers are. I think, in the spirit of SpotIQ, if you think about it comparatively, 15 years ago, 14 years ago when I joined Suncorp, people were operating on paper files and monthly reports in arrears. And now it's daily and intraday insights, not just graphs and charts. And if they want to drill down into them and have a look at an outlier, frontline staff and frontline leaders are driving down into the data and asking, 3, 4, 5 whys. And the example that you heard there of almost immediately finding these claims that, needed attention and had been neglected and had, fallen off the side of the vision of the leader, was a fantastic outcome, and it happened really, really fast.
Awesome. So given what you've already done, now what's the next phase with this use case, with ThoughtSpot generally look like?
So continuing to evolve the customer data in it. Like we've loaded the operational customer data, so our claims data, our policy data. We haven't yet loaded our customer records into it, so we're headed in that direction. We haven't loaded our phone data into it. So what we're trying to do is build out the sort of customer layer so that we get this complete view of the customer's journey. So that's one of them. And then going to the product and portfolio side of it. So one of the chaps you saw on the video, he's from product and pricing, mm-hmm. and they're now starting to use it to analyze how the portfolio changes over time. And the irony is, as an insurer, most executives like me were brought up to only believe things actuaries told you. And now, we're getting to a point where
the product and pricing team are actually driving into portfolio insights that they would have had to wait for actuarial valuation every quarter to start teasing out.
Awesome. Tim, thank you so much again for that. It was extremely beneficial, and again, an honor to have you here. Thank you.
My pleasure.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm next going to invite our strategic partner here, Accenture, in this particular domain. So let's, hang on, I should click further ahead, and that doesn't look like Nick. Nick, there you are. I think so. Anyway, Nick Millman, ladies and gentlemen. Nick, welcome. It's a pleasure to have you here.
Thank you.
Talk to us a bit about what you do and what Customer 360 means for Accenture.
Yes, I'm responsible in Accenture for the delivery of applied intelligence to our clients across Europe, Africa, Latin America, and Asia Pacific. And for us, applied intelligence is really about using data to drive value for our clients from analytics, AI, and automation. Accenture, as you probably know, is a big global organization. We just closed our fiscal year with $43 billion of revenues, which is great. It would be even greater if we had the same valuation multiple as ThoughtSpot, but we don't. And applied intelligence is actually one of those business areas that's really driving our revenue growth. We have more than 20,000 people globally providing applied intelligence to our clients, and a very significant proportion of those people are actually doing customer insight-related work, giving our clients the insights they need on their customers to drive their own growth. So for us, Customer 360 is a massive focus.
Awesome. So my next question, taking off from that, is what are some of the challenges your customers face when they want to deploy Customer 360 use cases?
Yeah, I guess we all know that really understanding a customer down to the individual level and getting away from the average level of understanding is complex, it's difficult. So what we do is quite a broad spectrum of things with data and analytics and AI to help with that. But I'd really break it down probably into three areas. I think first we've got kind of living marketing, which is all about using the insights to work out what to pitch, when to pitch it, and what kind of channel or channels would be the most effective. Then connected commerce, which is really around how do you drive your sales optimization, everything from better sales planning through to the customer targeting strategy through to optimizing sales spend. And then finally, the third area would really be around intelligent customer engagement, which is transforming customer service to make the service better, more personalized, and more predictive for the customer, whilst at the same time being cost-effective through driving it through the right channels. So it's a kind of way of driving more value whilst reducing cost.
Wonderful. So do me a favor, very quickly, boil all that down into a specific example for me.
Yeah. Of course. I think one really relevant example, which we've been working closely with ThoughtSpot on, is the work at Vodafone. Natalie from Vodafone is actually here, and she presented yesterday, gave a very good overview of the solution that we've been building together with ThoughtSpot to help Vodafone's commercial managers to understand their sales pipeline and how to price propositions for their business customers. And it's really about how to get that information to them more quickly and more easily and more accessible than it was before. So it's a really good success story for us working together.
Wonderful, wonderful. Nick, thank you so much for this. I really appreciate you coming.
Thank you.
Yeah. So ladies and gentlemen, to net it out, I have two thoughts. Yeah. So the first is, if you want to provide a personalized experience to each of your customers, then think about providing a holistic view of that customer to every person in your organization that is touching that customer. Yeah? The second takeaway for me is if you want to make the nightmares of traditional BI technology go away to enable this kind of a use case, and you want to get it done like this, consider getting it done with ThoughtSpot. Yeah? So that was Customer 360 for you. Thank you very much. I would now like to invite my colleague Priya Bhatia, who's also a customer success manager here. And she's going to talk to you about she's going to talk to you about the second pillar that Anuj was talking about, which is Supplier 360. Thank you, Priya. See you first.
Once you know what your customers want, how do you get it to them in the most cost-effective and efficient manner? Companies want to integrate their suppliers and partners into the strategies and systems, but the scale of data to influence that decision often holds them back. ThoughtSpot makes Supplier 360 possible. The result? Flexible and comprehensive views into your partner, supplier, product, order, and distribution warehouses to give you accurate and trusted answers on data at scale. Pinpoint changes in supply and demand to adjust your order and inventory levels accordingly. Gain more negotiation power over your suppliers and partners with data-driven insights and get the right product in the hands of the right customer in a timely manner. Let's talk to someone who's actually gone ahead and implemented this. I'd like to invite Mark from Baker Hughes on stage. Hi, Mark. Thank you for being here with us all the way from Germany.
Yeah, thank you. It's a pleasure.
Could you talk to us a little bit about what were the challenges that you were facing at Baker Hughes before you implemented ThoughtSpot?
Yeah, so we are a company, Baker Hughes, which is one of the largest oilfield service companies in the world. And we were really facing a challenge in regards to speed and performance. So actually, all our old legacy BI reports were having a lot of time to actually open it. And that was for sure really frustrating for our users. Besides that, it also always took a really long time from a development perspective to execute all the required changes into our reports. And another topic which has been coming up through all our journey on the challenges was that people were actually not getting all the required insights which they were trying to get through the legacy BI reports on a daily basis. So they were actually using our reports just as an extraction tool. So they were going in, setting a couple of filters, downloading the entire data, and then proceeding in classic Microsoft solutions like Excel, building their own pivot tables, their own graphs, and doing all of this stuff really manually. So what we were trying to achieve then was really an automated solution to avoid and to find a better way to our end users.
Great, thank you for that. What is the value of having your supply chain data in ThoughtSpot for your business?
Yeah, so for us, it's really a big productivity gain. So as I described before, users were actually going in doing all their manual analytics because all the insights which we are trying to get were not available on the fly. So they had to download it, to manipulate it, to really get the insights which they need for their day-to-day operations. Because we are having a lot of users, we are having users from a sourcing perspective, which are tactical buyers. We are having sourcing managers. We are having material specialists. And everybody is looking at sourcing data from different angles. So what we were trying to achieve and what we achieved is a huge productivity gain. So actually, people can now more focus on problem resolution and mitigate risk on activities which are sourcing related. So for example, that our goods can be delivered on time and that we can get the right savings from our suppliers in regards to cost savings opportunities, which we are seeing in ThoughtSpot. So having the data available on the fly in ThoughtSpot, knowing actually where are the challenges and then act accordingly is really a huge productivity gain instead of doing all the analytics manually.
So data at the point of decision making.
Correct.
Great. Thank you so much for being here with us, Mark.
Right. Thank you so much. All right.
I'd next like to invite one of our strategic partners, Guru from Wipro.
Hello, everyone.
Hi, Guru.
Hi, Priya.
Thank you for being here with us.
Pleasure.
So, what does Wipro see as the business value of supply chain analytics?
Well, yeah, I mean, as probably many of the audience would know, supply chain is a very wide area, but we see it as four key pillars: demand variability, supplier variability, network logistics, optimization, and the end-to-end monitoring and governance. And when we see, especially when it comes to analytics, there are key segments in each of these areas which we can help customers with, and we have been driving the benefits of that with the data analytics and AI for many of our customers, be it in terms of reducing the inventory time, be it in terms of optimizing the logistic routes, bit in terms of supplier quality capabilities, as well as the spend analytics, which is very pertinent to a lot of procurement people out there in every customer organization.
Great. What is the value of having access to granular insights in your supply chain data, and who really cares about it?
Well, I think when it comes to supplier and supply chain, there are three key segments, right? One is, how do we provide the superior customer experience? And it drives from each of these legs that I talked about. And if, when you really want to provide that superior customer experience, access to data becomes very critical. If I take one particular case in point about spend analytics, until unless we are able to track each and every transaction and better categorize the spend transactions, we will not be able to provide a significant value in terms of the cost optimizations for the organizations that can in turn deliver value to customers. And hence, ThoughtSpot and Wipro are working with a number of customers today in providing that capability to a lot of supply chain functions within the enterprises. And I see enabling and empowering more and more customers with that.
Great. Thank you so much for that. Thank you for your partnership, Guru.
Look forward to it. Thank you so much.
I'd next like to invite my colleague, Neil Coleman, who's going to talk about the third pillar that Anuj mentioned, which is Product 360.
Thank you, Priya. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for staying. Very happy to be talking to you today. So what does it mean to have a view, a 360-degree view of our product in ThoughtSpot? What that means is we can start from a very high level, a summary view of our products, and we can drill all the way down to a granular level of detail, all the way down to SKU, all the way down to item ID. But between those two areas, between that high-level view and that granular view, are all those attributes that make up our product. Things like style, color, size, cost. And we use all of those attributes to determine which of our products are profitable in the market. And once we've identified and we've found those insights, we're not limited to that single view. With ThoughtSpot, we can very easily take those products that are selling in the marketplace, and we can ask other questions. Where are we selling these products? Tell me about the customers that are buying these. What age group? What income bracket? So our Product 360 gives us a full view of those products so we understand where we're profitable. It helps us with our marketing and our promotion strategies as well. So to just discuss this further, I'd like to invite Glenn from Verizon to join me on stage. Hey, Glenn.
Hey, thanks for having me.
So how has ThoughtSpot added value to Verizon?
So ThoughtSpot's really added value to Verizon in two really main ways. The first one is really how we attack our analytic lifecycle. And what I mean by that is traditionally your lifecycle includes gathering business requirements, data curation, visualization, and then delivery to your customer. Now, whether this happens a day, week, month after that, your customer invariably finds you with another question that wasn't part of that scope. So back to the lifecycle we go. Now, what ThoughtSpot has enabled us to do is really think about that data curation bit a little bit more thoughtfully. And again, what I mean by that is you're always going to get your business requirements, but ultimately, what you need to do is think about how we're bringing in extra attributes, extra measures that help build a full product view of what's being asked of you. So what we've been able to do is really reduce the number of times that our customers have to come back to that life cycle and ask those questions because we've already answered them in the data set.
Great, thank you. And so how are you using ThoughtSpot to analyze the products that Verizon sells?
Sure. So one of the main or major events that we've had over the past month, you might have heard of it, but we did launch an Apple iPhone back in September. So with ThoughtSpot, we've been able to drive a lot of conversation at executive leadership level, using ThoughtSpot as the backdrop for that conversation. And with this launch, we've been able to ask some questions that we're able to drill into real time. And you know, a perfect example of that, and it's an anecdote, but it's a microcosm of the larger use case for ThoughtSpot. And that question was, well, how are people procuring those devices, right? With the advent of device payment plans, with Apple, Samsung, all opening up their own device financing programs, whether they're buying the device outright, we're able to drill down into the data from the macro level to that next layer down. And not only are we able to understand not how we did this year from a distribution standpoint, but how we did in previous launches. And then we take it a step further to understand really how did the rest of the company do, right? Because our use cases within our digital organizations, so VerizonWireless.com and our mobile app, but we're able to, within a matter of seconds, understand not only what our benchmarks are, but what the benchmarks were for the rest of the company. And again, that is a matter of seconds, and we're able to continue to drive that conversation forward and take action against it.
Great. Yeah. Glenn, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. This way. Sorry. So now I'd like to invite one of our strategic partners, Flex. I'd like to invite Samara to the stage.
Hi,
hey,
Neil.
Samara.
Hi.
So maybe you can start by telling us a little bit about Flex.
Of course. Flex is pretty much the brand behind the brands. We design, manufacture, and distribute for over 1,000 customers globally. For those of you that don't know much about the company and our scale, we operate in over 35 countries through 120 different sites, which are design centers, service centers, and factories. A $25 billion in revenue company with over 200,000 employees worldwide, operate in all 16 industries with revenue in over $1 billion in 12 of them.
Great, thank you. And so how has ThoughtSpot added value to your organization?
So like I mentioned, I mean, Flex is a very complex ecosystem, and it's really important for us to make sure that our decision makers have access to very complex data sets to make data-driven decisions at all times. The manufacturing and supply chain space is rapidly changing. A colleague said that now we need to respond at the speed of a tweet. So that's the kind of speed and access to data that we need. There's a lot of customization that customers are requesting. There's regionalization in the supply chain. There is a lot of, product life cycles are shorter. There is product lead times are getting really key. And to drive all of this change, we need access to data, and we need to make use of the data that we're generating. To give you a very quick example, we digitized our supply chain about 4 years ago, and now we get real-time data from each of our 120 sites worldwide, and we have thousands of people within Flex analyzing this data and looking for anomalies. Oh. Taking out a day of inventory from our supply chain is $60 million in cash for us.
Wow.
So we see ThoughtSpot being a very key enabler in this ecosystem and a very important strategic partner for us.
Great. Samara, thank you very much.
Absolutely.
Nice Samara is actually, and Samara is heading to go speak at another booth. So if you want to learn more about Flex, she's got a session coming up, in 30 minutes?
Yes, 1 p.m. Right.
Thank you, Samara.
Thank you.
So again, thank you, everyone, for staying. I'm going to introduce Anuj and welcome him back to the stage. You are, sir.
Thanks. All right. I know it's getting late, so we'll make it pretty quick. We have a very special guest that I'd like to introduce. This is Elon Musk. Okay, so we couldn't quite get him, but we went to Plan T, which is to get Tony. They both are of South African heritage, so we said, we'll get Tony. So, Tony.
Thank you.
may have lost Tony. There he is.
Thank you, Nish. Much appreciated. Thank you.
He does look like Elon, doesn't he?
No, not really. Hey, thank you for still staying with me. This is going to be a very quick segment. This is the second part of the marketplace introduction. Just a quick refresher from yesterday. The marketplace is an online resource for you to help you fast-track your value on ThoughtSpot with partner solutions and technologies. And today we have three of our partners with us that are going to be just quickly explaining what solutions they have on the marketplace and the value to you. So with that, I would like to invite on stage Kumar Amitesh from TCS, who is the VP of the Solutions and Data and Analytics Solutions, Kevin Miller from Snowflake, and Jay Warren from Cognizant, also the VP of AI and Analytics.
He's on.
Welcome. Yay.
Yeah.
So we went from slow to very fast.
But I'm coming.
Yeah, there you are. There. Can you see how tall these guys are? It's amazing, yeah. Mm-hmm. Good. Amitesh, let's start with you. Give us a quick intro of yourself, TCS, and the solution you have on the marketplace for our customers.
Yeah, hi, everyone. Good to be here. I represent TCS Tata Consultancy Services.
Yeah.
It's a global IT services, business solutions, and digital transformation partner for our customers. Revenues of 21 billion plus. And one of the things we are driving is basically working with our customers on the growth and transformation journey for a business 4.0 transformation, which essentially means how are they leveraging technology pillars like agility, intelligence, cloud, and automation to drive the business outcomes in terms of mass personalization, value creation, exponential value creation. Also leveraging the ecosystem, which is all around us, and also driving customer experience in the journey. So while we look at the technology pillars and the cultural behavior business outcome changes, the underlying link is the data which flows within the organization. And I manage the global sales and solution for the data analytics portfolio, which we work with customers for.
Yes. Thank you,
I saw some of the sessions today, and one of the things which I realized was linking technology to business outcomes or driving business adoption on all the technology investments is one of the prime initiatives which is getting done across organization. And today, while technologically we have sound systems in place, we have all the AI, ML techniques, the tools, cloud and other architectures available. As long as businesses are not driving the adoption, it all kinds of doesn't generate the right amount of business value. So as part of A&I unit, what we focus on are three core areas. One is the data foundation, getting the data foundation right, which is basically looking at the data quality, the data governance, the universal data versus the enterprise data, and whether you're able to get the data which is important for you into one foundational aspect. Once you have understood the core of your business and what data will drive value, you get into the modernization aspect, so which is another angle we look at, which is the technology enablement, the cloud and big data solutions, the data lake, etc. But the most important part for us is the third segment, which is the business analytics portfolio, driving the business outcomes. And that is where we work with partners like ThoughtSpot in terms of driving that business adoption and the outcomes related to this.
Yeah, thank you, Amitesh. And tell us a little bit about the solution you have on the marketplace today.
So on the marketplace, we are ready with the solution on the mortgage business analytics, which is basically doing the risk profiling of all the mortgage application, which will be very useful for the banks and the financial services in this space. We are also working on some of the other aspects, which we will announce later as we
Thank you very much. Much appreciate the partnership, and the mortgage analytics solution is already very, very valuable. And I've already gotten quite a few requests on those. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Amitesh, and thank you for the partnership with TCS. Please stay on stage. Kevin
yes.
from Snowflake. Kevin, you're the VP of the system integrators at Snowflake. Mm-hmm. Give us a quick introduction of yourself. You know, we are all excited about the partnership with Snowflake.
Sure.
And then maybe just go through the quickly go through the three solutions that we have
sure.
on the marketplace for our joint customers.
Yeah, absolutely. So I think you, by the way, first of all, have a great basketball team.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Lined up.
You are the tallest.
In case we fail at what we do, we can always do that.
Yeah,
so
yeah, yeah.
That'll be good. So Kevin Miller, I am the VP of System Integrators at Snowflake. Been there for roughly 10 months.
Yeah.
I won't really go through a ton of what Harsh already repeated earlier in the
session.
Yeah,
absolutely.
What it is that we do. But I think it is, when you look at the data-driven world, how Snowflake is accelerating the use of data with the customer, right? And I think that's really our power. We are across all three clouds, and then we have great technology partners like ThoughtSpot. So
yeah, perfect.
Excited to be here.
Cool. And you got to mention the three solutions. They're all completely built on Snowflake, the IoT, procurement, and Customer 360.
Yeah, absolutely. So those three, I think when I look at those, it's really about the connective tissue, quite frankly, that the entire ecosystem brings to bear, right?
Yeah.
And you know, when you look at IoT, and I think when you look at ThoughtSpot and that hyper speed that you provide, and the combination with Snowflake and putting that on Atlas, I think customers will be able to absorb that really well. When you go into Customer 360 and think about that full cycle and how you look at a buyer's behavior within your business is also going to be key, and that's powered alongside with Snowflake, as well as the final one, which is around procurement.
Yeah.
And getting that full cycle understanding of supply chain and what that looks like as you go through
Perfect.
Your day-to-day. So,
I mean, like, one of the things that we've noticed on our end is that if customers leave their data in Snowflake, they automatically lower their total cost of ownership, which
Absolutely.
Is a huge benefit as part of the collaboration.
Absolutely.
So thank you very much, Kevin.
Thank you.
Jay.
Yes.
So, Jay, you're the VP of AI and Analytics at Cognizant.
Yes.
Same question, quick intro, and
sure.
just a quick overview of the two solutions you have on the marketplace,
sure.
the Atlas marketplace.
So as as Tony was mentioning, my role is the Vice President of Artificial Intelligence and Analytics at Cognizant. And I'd like to just start out being a former military person, that our mission is to help enable our customers to actually add value and add outcomes via AI-driven, a customer-focused, and a platform approach. So really, background on me, I've been in the business for about 25 years. I have I'd say two-thirds of that has been in the data space, the other third of it's been on the analytics space. And today my role is more so on the analytics and driving business outcomes perspective. So as I sat down and I've looked at everything that ThoughtSpot is doing, it's right in alignment with what we're trying to accomplish at Cognizant, is what our sort of AI-focused, platform-driven approach. And the platform that ThoughtSpot brings to the table allows customers to actually interact with their business with the visualization tools so that they can drive outcomes from a business perspective. And a couple of things, as we look at that, it always starts with the data. If you don't, it's the saying is garbage in, garbage out, and it truly is true. So, and that doesn't matter if you got the greatest AI in the world. If you give it the wrong information, you're going to get the wrong results. Just think about the Microsoft Tay experiment, and that sort of brings you to bear there. So specifically on the data side, we have what we call Platinum, which is in essence, it's a platform for information value management. It gives you complete lineage from start to stop to when the data shows up to the client, and obviously from the integration perspective. Allows you to also make changes underneath the system as it goes along to, if there's updates, let's say specifically to columns or rows or data that you're looking for, you're able to do that in an efficient manner. Ultimately, that leads to what we'll say is the interface, and we have chatbots or conversational AI interfaces that allow you to not only get the reports, get the visualization, but take some of that information that SpotIQ provides and allows you to say, these are the reports that are most important to you. These are the ones that are going to drive the decisions. And by the way, I can deliver that either via a typical or traditional report layout, or I can drive it via a dashboard, or quite frankly, I can send you a message via a chatbot so that you can get exactly what you need at the right moment and right time. So I'm very excited about this partnership with ThoughtSpot and very, very excited to sort of drive this new wave of let's go towards decision performance versus just key performance.
Thank you very much, Jay. We're also very grateful to be part of your business. Same with Snowflake, Kevin, Amitesh, thank you very much.
Yep. Thank
Jay,
you,
thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Kevin, yep. Amitesh, thank you very thank much. You. Much thank appreciated. You, yeah, have a good one. With that, that concludes our vibrant partner ecosystem segment. Thank you for the applause, by the way. And then with that, I'm going to want to wrap with bringing Scott Holden back on stage, our chief marketing officer. Scott, take it home. There you go.
All right, everybody. We're wrapping up our program here and about to head to lunch. Just a couple of quick housekeeping items. If you want to see more of these customers or partners around the world, we are launching the ThoughtSpot Thought Leaders Global Tour. And this has already been underway through some of the spring and summer. But you can see that we're going around the world, putting on a program much like this one. So if you see your city up there, please check it out. And we'd love to see you there. For the rest of the program here, we've got the Solution Showcase. Obviously, we want you to go and get demos from there. We've got this sponsor passport program. If you haven't filled out your card yet, they're due at 1 o'clock today. So go do that. Take your photo in the photo booth. And then lastly, we have our final keynote of the day today at 4:15. Maria Yao is going to talk to us about the state of AI in the enterprise. So come back for that. And then last but not least, we're going to do an executive Q&A with the ThoughtSpot leadership team at 5 o'clock today. So if you've got a burning question for anyone on the team, me, Sudhish, Ajit, we'll have all of our leadership here. Anything goes. So thank you all for such great attention this morning, and we'll see you in a little bit. Cheers. Let's go surfing now. Everybody's learning how. Come on a safari with me. They're kicking out the Doheny.